This one? I don't know where I'm looking. Where's my jib? Is the jib going to come down? Okay. We are taping a live trade deadline BS podcast. My name is Bill Simmons. I'm here with Ryen Russillo. We did this last year. I can't remember. Did it work out last year?
Yeah, it went
Do we have any
great.
Fun trades? What was the most fun trade last year?
I think that was the – was that the Joe Johnson trade?
Joe Johnson.
To Phoenix?
Let's go through the trades. The ones that have happened. The biggest one, Golden State takes a flyer on Wiggins. They get a top three protected 2020 pick. Minnesota gets D'Angelo Russell. I'll start with Minnesota. This is just a complete panic trade by Minnesota because Towns is so unhappy. He's lost 100 games in a row. He's starting to send out feelers around the league that I'm aware of that he's bummed out. He doesn't want to stay there. And I think Wiggins was a part of that. And it was one of those, look, you got to do something. Do you think it was directly, you got to get Wiggins out of here? Or was it, do you got to do something?
I think it's both.
Good answer.
You know, when you look at like tanking, and not saying everybody tanks the same way, but this was kind of the version of it where you go, hey, it actually is working for these guys.
Yeah.
Like these guys are getting picks. Now, granted, the Wiggins pick was the Cleveland thing with Love. But, you know, whenever you tank for a few years, you hope to have these two pieces. Kind of like right now with Memphis. You hope with Ja and Jaren Jackson. You're like, okay, we've got these two things that we can build on.
And you have to go two for two with those high lottery picks.
Absolutely. I mean, and even Philly probably whiffed on two of the four,
right?
But they ended up with two guys that we still don't know. It looks like they're less likely to be able to play with each other. So that was very early. We got to Sixers problems.
Wow.
But
that was the drinking game. People already had to do a shot.
Minnesota was that thing where you go, look at this. Like, we've got this incredible wing guy who at the very worst is like 20 points a game, is going to play lockdown defense. And honestly, like, he gets 20 a game, doesn't play great defense. And then Towns, who 2 years ago in the GM poll was the number one choice of who you'd want to start your franchise with.
That's amazing.
And now you're like, look at these numbers, and they keep losing all the time. They have the worst record since a 10-8 start in the NBA. So,
well, you named him to your all miserable all NBA
captain
team at the halfway mark. Captain.
Yeah.
Which Bradley Beal, I just heard from some third parties, was upset he wasn't the captain. He vowed to up the stakes.
Was he upset or was his girlfriend upset?
Maybe both of them were. But Towns, the last week or so, really started to look like he actually had like appendicitis or something on the court. Like, it actually looks like there's something medically wrong with him. Just had this crazy, unhappy look on his face.
You watch it and you go, oh my God, like, this guy's absolutely miserable. But, you know, I think the irony of this is D'Angelo Russell the fix here? And I'm not meaning fix like, hey, you're now contending for titles. I'm talking about, like, if Towns is this good and Wiggins was the disappointment, and you think Russell, like, the perception of Russell now is that he's a much better player than Wiggins, and I think that's something we could even talk about.
Yeah.
Russell's completely revamped, or I don't know, I would say the redemption of his career started last year, where 2 years ago I thought he was just sort of a high usage, you know, kind of like almost a pig in a sense.
Right.
Like, and then last year is like, wait a minute, this is going to work. We know why Golden State did it, to have an asset instead of zero assets, so we'll get to their side of it. But this reeks of panic and all the other moves around it.
Well, also two CAA guys.
And I still don't know what it means for them as a team. Like, if this is really like something that's supposed to work, they should be a locked playoff team. It's probably too late this year, but next year.
Go backwards. Golden State gets Russell.
Yeah.
In the Durant trade. They're really smart. They actually outthought some teams there because they were looking at this situation. They realized Durant's leaving. And they go, is there any way to salvage this? Russell seems like he's heading to Minnesota. We all know the Brooklyn's going to renounce Kyrie. Renounce Russell to sign Kyrie and KD, which will then allow Minnesota to just sign Russell. Golden State gets proactive. They grab Russell. A borderline all-star, a guy who's
23
a night and kind of fits in with where the league's playing now. Golden State just got a free look at him for 50 games. And they're like, we're good. We'll get rid of this guy for Andrew Wiggins. I look at that, and I'm Minnesota. I'm like, why are they so anxious to trade this guy? Is a more intriguing thing to me. And look, I think we can talk. I really liked Russell last year. I actually thought it made more sense for Brooklyn to keep him than do the Kyrie thing because of Kyrie, all the baggage stuff that he brings. Russell ties into this problem I'm having with basketball in general right now, where he can do these specific things really well, but that's all he can do. You can set him a screen, and he's really good at – he can move probe, up that, right, do a little pop or whatever. Or he can do a little ISO. He's always 25 feet from the basket. He doesn't get to the free throw line at all. I think he's a good guy to have on your team, and he seems like a good character guy now. I'm not sure he'd be that fun to play with. And they obviously assessed this and said, this guy doesn't fit with Clay and Steph.
So that's a really good point because, you know, when you watch D'Angelo when he was in college, I think the great thing was some of the stuff that he – the decisions he made with the basketball. Like, it wasn't just, hey, let's run this high screen and roll. Let's do all these things. And when, again, 2 years ago, he had this usage rate where you're like, this is – like almost borderline Westbrook level usage, and you're not as productive as Westbrook. And he plays a little bit like when Harden used to play in a lot of that pick and roll stuff. And
it's the kind of basketball we hate.
It is. Like,
I have
Portland
the ball 30
game,
feet from the basket. Right. You guys all stand here. I'm going to do stuff. It's productive, but I think for them, it's like, what is this ultimately when Steph and Clay come back? This isn't how we want to play.
Well, that's a real thing, and it's a good question because I did talk to somebody earlier in the week going, like, what do you think Golden State's trying to do here? And when I had first heard, like, Wiggins, and by the way, the pieces they move out here, I'm assuming they got under that repeater tax thing by moving out Evans and Amari Spellman in this deal too. So Golden State wanted the tax relief, although I don't believe it was a mandate based on people that I talked to, that they were still going to be okay going into this summer with their own pick and Russell.
By the way, that was bullshit. They wanted to get under the tax.
No, I know they wanted to.
They tried to trade Mookie Betts, and they realized he wasn't on the team.
Do you think the Mookie Betts thing is just a Hulu ad? Is there any chance? All right, just checking with you. We'll have a Mookie Betts breakdown a little bit later. So this is the part that I think, like, it's guilty because, like, when the Warriors do it, that they're smart. But, like, nobody, everybody was, the basketball community was collectively off of Wiggins.
Yeah.
But I really think from just a basketball fit positionally, based on people I talked to, that Golden State liked Wiggins with that backcourt better than D'Angelo.
By the way, same stats. He's also 23 a night.
That'd be a really sneaky, like, if you did a vote right now, who's a better player, D'Angelo, Russell,
if
or Wiggins?
If I just did the player A, player B with the stats, you'd be like, wait, they have this same stats. He's only, how old is he? 1995. He's 24. I think he gives
Are you talking to yourself in a Wiggins right now?
I'm not.
Okay,
I'm not.
Just making sure.
I think he gives them more flexibility when Clay and Curry come back, though. And if I'm Golden State,
that's what they believe, by the way. So that's not you just guessing. It's true.
Yeah. So if you're Golden State and you look at it and you go, all right, we just got a 50-game sample size of Russell. Here's Wiggins. When Clay and Curry come back and we have Draymond, what kind of person do we want in that third spot next to those guys? We want a guy who's a wing, who's interchangeable.
They want a small forward.
Can play defense. Right. He can play up as a small forward.
I still don't know how good his defense is, but well, he's passing more. I mean, you know.
But if you're Golden State, you look at Minnesota and you're like, this is a top three team you'd want to trade for a talented guy from. This guy's had how many coaches? He had Tibbs. He had the guy before Tibbs. He has
Saunders.
Flip's kid, who I'm not
Ryen.
Really sold on. And dysfunctional team. Towns, certainly not the guy who can be the best player on a really good team, I don't think, just based on his personality. And you're like, you feel like this is a distressed asset that you're grabbing. You put him into your Golden State system. You have him with all the shooting coaches. He's got the best locker room. He's around guys who play their ass off every day, like Curry and Draymond and Clay, like real pros. And you put somebody like that with those guys, and it's like embarrassing if you're not working as hard as them. It's embarrassing if you don't give a shit during the game. Because those guys really give a shit. So I actually think it's a good bet. I think it's the one team he could have gone to that maybe he can be salvaged as a real impact guy.
And they get minimal protection, top three protection in 2021 on that pick. They get the second rounder. So they ended up getting extra in here. There's also a Warriors bet that it's like you added Russell. You added all these different pieces. You know, they've revamped a lot of the second half of their rotation with all these other secondary deals that they've done outside of this big one, the Covington deal. And then the other Memphis deal, which came through. But
they're
probably looking at being like, hey, you guys are still going to be bad. And this pick. And so now it's
the fifth pick.
Right. And so
they could have two top five picks. And the other thing is you need a big contract if you're going to make a trade.
And that's all.
So Wiggins could be a piece where you're like, we'll give you one of these first round picks with Wiggins. Now give us somebody who's actually better than Wiggins and you're back in business. And they had no flexibility, in my opinion, if Durant leaves and they get nothing. So the way they've played this little Jenga stack they've built, It's pretty good.
It's
now they
really
have an extra
smart,
first round
right.
pick with Wiggins. Wiggins is tradable. Somebody else would take a chance on him, but he might actually be good for them.
Yeah, that's how everything in this deal has to be looked at, is that the dumb organizations go, oh, we lost Durant. You know,
right.
We'll see what happens. You know, let's kick the tires on who's left over in two weeks.
Or the really dumb organizations on June 30th would have been saying, I don't know. Rich Kleiman said he'd call us at 3. You
yeah.
never know. He might yeah. change his mind. That's like the really dumb organization.
Why is he on the boardroom with a Knicks hat on?
why is he interviewing David Falk? They knew where this was going. And I think the fact that they proactively were able to get an asset for him was really impressive.
Absolutely.
And Russell's good. I like Russell. I just don't know for that team if it makes sense. This is his destiny. With Towns, we're a team. Marbury and Garnett 22 years ago. Now it's us. Two guys who can put up 30 in any game. They'll be more fun. The energy will change. They'll start killing Wiggins, and they'll start leaking stuff, right, in a couple days?
I don't think they have to leak stuff. I mean, you could watch Wiggins over the years and go, hey, we need a little bit more out of you, man. Like, you can't be the invisible man.
Oh, we have a trade.
Oh, all right.
Shabazz Napier straight up for Jordan McRae.
So LeBron couldn't get him?
Yeah, where's LeBron? LeBron was so in on Shabazz Napier.
So in on him, they drafted him, and he left.
More trades we got to go through.
Okay.
Clippers got Marcus Morris. Knicks got Harkless and a first.
It's basically the first.
As somebody who has Clipper season tickets and was really rooting for them to get to the finals, I hate this trade for them. I watched Marcus Morris on the Celtics for 3 years. I think on the right team, he has a purpose and has real value. He is a ball stopper. The ball goes to him, and it stops. And if you watch the Clippers really carefully, George is a ball stopper in a lot of ways. Kawhi is a ball stopper, although he's Kawhi. The Lou Williams, give the ball to him. Harrell sets a pick. That's a ball stopper. It's a team where nobody's moving ever. And now you're adding a guy who's basically a statue. And if you throw him the ball, he's going to take 7 seconds to decide what to do. So now I have Kawhi, Paul George, Harrell, Lou Williams, all standing in different spots while Marcus Morris is deciding what to do. And, you know, the flip side, they would be like, well, he's a good open three-point shooter. He was never comfortable with that in Boston. He wanted to – the problem with having a guy like Marcus Morris is with a minute left, down one in Game 7 of the Western Conference Finals, he'll think he should shoot.
Yeah.
He'll be like, "Actually, Kawhi, let me take this."
Yeah.
That's why you can't have a guy like this. I don't like the trade.
I can't believe that we agree. And you had such a bad time at Morris, you had an extra year as Boston run. He was only there 2 years.
It felt like three.
I'm like, wait.
No,
I think,
honestly,
yeah.
It felt like three.
He was a really nice contract, too, when Boston had him. I actually thought it was kind of like a low-key, like, oh, that's kind of a smart deal because you know this guy's in your rotation. You know that he can play. He is shooting the cover off the ball. He's 44% from three right now on 6 attempts per game.
In a bunch of games, that mean nothing,
nope.
Where he's getting a ton of touches.
I get it. It's 20
points a
game.
Ton of touches.
But he looks right now like the best version of him.
Yeah.
But I do think it's a byproduct of, like, what that team has. So, you know, the Knicks get back this first rounder. It probably, as we learn more about, and that's probably – one of the hardest things doing this in real time is like, oh, it's actually this kind of protection. Oh, this is actually what the deal is.
Well, let's call it what it is. It's probably the 24th pick in what might be the worst draft in 20 years.
Yeah. So if they were getting all these calls, remember too, it was like, you know, Knicks don't want to trade him because he feels like a Nick. He feels like Oakley. He feels like Mason. He feels like, okay, you
now. Did you believe one inch of that?
No, I didn't. But I just, these are the things
that are floating
around.
I love when people go, we'd never trade. This guy means so much. That to me, that's like you're putting them on the block.
Yeah. A lot of teams, like, when the Clippers were maybe linked to some other people and you're going, they can move Landry Shamet. And I like Landry Shamet. Like, the Sixers would love to have Landry Shamet still for what he is. But, like, sometimes you go, like, how high are you rating the seventh or eighth guy that you have on your team? Morris,
it's 11:45.
Yeah.
So we haven't had all the trades yet. To me, like, Danny Green is a guy like that. I don't know if the Lakers would trade him or not, but it was like, oh, they can't trade Danny Green. He's great. It's like, they'll trade Danny Green. They'll trade whoever they can get if they feel like they can get a third star.
But the
whatever
Lakers,
it will take, they'll do.
The Lakers rumors with Morris is like, okay, it starts with Kuzma, and now we have to. And you're like, wait a minute, why would you want Morris more than Kuzma?
Yeah,
I don't.
No. Also, why would you want to trade a guy who's a $2 million contract for a guy who's a free agent who makes 15?
Yeah, I honestly, like, I think Morris is really talented. If he keeps shooting like this, it'll be worth it. He's not going to put up the same kind of production. But I think the biggest problem, and maybe it's more Markieff, but Marcus had it in him a little bit too. Like, toughness to me is facing adversity. It's not shoving another guy when you're down 20 and you lost. And
it's fair.
Those guys, I've watched it enough. Maybe it's more Markieff when he was with the Wizards, but it just go, you know, I know you guys are big, tough guys and you're physical, but being mad is not always being tough. And there'd be times where you're like, oh, okay, you're just taking a cheap shot at somebody right now because the game's already lost. Like, we needed you to be tough in the first quarter.
I actually thought Denver was the team that made the most sense for him. And I do like Morris on the right team. I'm just saying he's on the wrong team. The Clippers, where he's going to really have to take a step back and be a complimentary guy, and I don't think he wants to do that. But if you're on Denver, where that team is going to ebb and flow in a playoff series depending on whether Jamal Murray is feeling it or not, as we saw last year.
He was awesome. He had 28 through three quarters last night.
So you watched them yesterday and you're like, I get it. I see the path to Denver winning the title and all the stuff they're doing, then Jokic down the stretch. But I wish they had a third guy who, when Murray doesn't have it in game four of the second round and they're playing somewhere and Jokic has three fouls, you kind of need that guy who's like, I got it. I'll take some shots. And that was the best Marcus Morris quality. Like, you saw when Kyrie went out that year during the playoff run, there were games when, like, Tatum had deer in the headlights, Brown had deer in the headlights, Rozier can't make anything. And Morris is like, I got this guy, and he'll actually make some shots. I don't think that's what the Clippers needed. I actually thought if I was going to use that Harkless thing in a pick, I'm going one of two ways. Either I'm improving the Harrell spot because I don't think they're big enough in a Lakers series. I just don't.
But they keep beating them.
And I would improve I would improve the Shamet spot, because that was the one where it's like, I want a better version of Shamet. Who is that? Is it a JJ Redick type? Is it Spencer
Dinwiddie?
Okay,
but JJ wasn't going anywhere. It doesn't look like Jrue was going anywhere. Dinwiddie's name was all over the place the last couple of days, so I don't know what that is. I mean, we could add him to all miserable team as the starting point guard, because as soon as the Kyrie stuff in and out, you could just see it. Like, hey, this is way more fun when I'm doing this, and we were winning games.
Well, so maybe you trade for a guy who's got a contract next year too, because if you're the Clippers, you have no way to improve next year's team either. You have all these contracts that are packed a certain way, and you have Harrell as a free agent, and you don't have really the ability to grab anybody. But if you grab somebody who's making 15 a year for next year too, now I have this other asset. This is a problem the Celtics have had the last couple of years, where they don't have that one tradable contract, and they're not in any of these trades because they don't have it. They never were able to roll it over where, oh, next year we have the Jorgie Dang contract. He's 15 expiring.
Don't try that one again.
Gorgie? Georgie?
No, it's a tough one. I screwed it up all the time.
You know I have pronunciation dyslexia.
What's going on with the Princess Bride look out of you today?
I grew it for the thing.
I like that.
I knew we had a big trade deadline thing. I wanted to wear a hat and look like one of the Three Musketeers.
I almost didn't change into something nice.
So you, thumbs up or thumbs down? Last verdict, thumbs up or thumbs down for Marcus Morris on the Clippers?
It's a meh. Like, I'm not so much.
It's a meh.
Yeah. Like, there's times where I watch the Clippers and I go, oh, I don't know. Like, is this Lou Williams thing always going to work in the playoffs? Like, are all these pick and rolls always going to work with Montrez? But Montrez's energy level is so high that he's, like, already at playoff energy level, so I don't really worry about him.
Would you have rather done that or Zubac, Harkless, and a number one for Tristan Thompson, who could actually play for me in crunch time against the Lakers?
Yeah, Tristan still moves really well. Like, it's something we just ignore because we're not watching a ton of Cavs games. Yeah, because I think Zubac is absolutely unplayable in certain playoff matchups, and we're going to see that.
Yeah, I love that they're like, he's an asset. Look at the stats. His PR, it's 22. I'm like, all right,
PR
good luck.
For bigs that don't play a lot is always
– You're not going to be able to play him in the fourth quarter of a really important playoff game. He will not be on the floor.
I actually really like your Denver call, because the Millsap thing, like, he didn't play last night. They had a really short rotation. They ended up getting a really nice win against a Jazz team that, you know, you're going, all right, the Jazz are going to win this game. They're up again. They have another run. And then they ran all this two-man stuff with just – I mean, they always run two-man stuff with Jokic and Murray, but last night was so exaggerated where it was like, hey, you three guys, go stand over there. They had no Porter Jr. So if Denver really has a chance of coming out of the West, I would have loved to add a scorer like Morris. So I completely agree with that about what a better fit would be. But every one of these trades, man, like, hey, would you have rather done this instead? Like, I do think we make that mistake a lot of times. We're like, oh, I don't like this trade. It's like, okay, but what else do we know that was actually even obtainable?
Right.
And I think we make that mistake a lot.
Well, so let's go back to Utah for a second.
Yeah.
The Conley thing's not good.
Last night, offensively, it was good, but it was so bad defensively.
I always thought he was pretty frisky defensively. And you think about those Grizzlies teams in 2012, 13, 14.
great. And
him and Tony Allen, and I always thought like it was pretty high level perimeter D. What we saw last night was alarming, and the fact that Denver was basically torturing him, and they're like, "Where is he? Let's go get him on offense." If I'm a Utah fan, I'm alarmed, and I was wondering if he was a possible trade target today.
Well,
if they went to Oklahoma City and they're like, "We'll give you Conley for Chris Paul, and we'll take that extra Chris Paul year off your hands, and we'll throw in our 2022 first." In Utah, it's like, all right, that's a lot of Chris Paul. You got him 2 years after this, $44 million.
He's playing great this year.
At the same time, it's like the guy's one of the best 22 players in the league.
Right.
Conley is not.
When Paul showed up, they were like, look, we're going to rest you. We're going to do this. We're going to, you know, we want to. And Chris Paul's like, hey, your whole rest plan? Nah. Like, I'm not doing that.
He's like, I'm finally on a normal basketball team for the first time in 10 years.
They were like, they had this whole thing mapped out for him. And Paul was like, yeah, fuck that.
Right.
Like, see, I love hearing that story, and it's worked there, but that's...
So when you talk about, like...
Let's give Conley a little bit more time before we're ready to write him off, but it was so bad that they actually switched it up where they put Ingles on Murray, and then Denver was really smart because then they ran Morris off some, like, wing screen where they ended up with Morris on Conley, and then he worked him, and I was like, oh, man, like, this is bad. And it was really, really impressive what Denver did last night to close that game.
It was a little like a playground thing where everybody's throwing the ball. There's the one kid in the middle, and they're throwing the ball over his head and playing keep away with him, where it's just like, all right, this is cruel, guys. Can you just stop? You're torturing this poor kid. That's how I felt for Conley yesterday, where just that he was at the specific point of his career, which a lot of NBA players hit, where you're like, oh, I'm that guy now? He's like the Nickelback on the playoff team. That's just every play is being run out.
Are you reading my tweets for your content? I said he looks like a corner that was called up from the practice squad.
I didn't read that one.
Yeah, that's all right. You've been busy. Can we give Conley like another couple of weeks though before we're ready to ask him to retire?
How hurt do you think he still is?
He was really good on offense last night.
Yeah, so I actually feel like he's got to be 90%+ healthy.
Yeah, it was.
Utah and Denver are probably going to cross paths in the first two rounds, and I would be alarmed if I were them.
And
but,
you know, I did one of those classic like observation versus prediction thing, and Gobert early dunking on him.
Yep.
Dunking on Jokic, and then you go, Jokic hit this absurd step back that even for him, you're like, wait a minute, are you bored and you took that shot, or did you just go, hey, I want to see if this goes in? And then he ends up with like 30, 20, 10, triple-double. So,
Jokic, weirdest year of any good player this season. If you catch him almost by the quarter, you're like, is this guy, is he hurt? Is he about to have knee surgery? And then you watch another quarter, you're like, oh, yeah, he's one of the best eight players in the league. And it just really depends on the quarter.
And he has like five or six goofy moments every game where like if he touches the ball when he wasn't supposed to, he's like, oh, you know, sorry. Right. Here's a question for you, though. Do you think that during the course of his game, his arms get so red from just all the interior play that his passes become harder to detect because the ball's the same skin color as his red arms? Has anybody else pointed this out?
It is like he is in the Hall of Fame of...
We got a trade.
Oh. Okay, so that's a three-teamer now with Isaiah Thomas going to the Clippers. Mixed reviews on him this year.
Yeah, you know, when anytime you talk about Isaiah, it's almost like, oh, you know, one of those deals.
A bummer.
Yeah, it is.
There was a tweet. The Celtics basically, @KeithSmithNBA. He said one of the teams heavily engaged around the league in trade talks is the Boston Celtics.
Not in Capela, though. I was told that was a...
There was anger.
It was a Maury special on that one.
Can you imagine running a team where you're just like sitting in your office having lunch at 12:30 and then some tweet comes out, you're heavily engaged and talks with Clint Capela, and you're like, fucking Daryl! What a dick!
Why does he do that? I
bet
you... Well, you know, because you know what happened. Like, the deal was close, the four-team deal with Capela, And then my favorite Capela anecdote was he the lowest ranked player to ever be somebody classified as we need to send this guy to the other conference? Like, who's been less talented? And I kind of like Clint Capela in certain spells.
So you're saying Clint Capela, I think they Clint weren't Capela, afraid he was going to come back to haunt them?
I think Clint Capela should be the floor of, we gotta get, if we do move this guy, there's no fucking way we can go through him in the playoffs.
Like, who had more red blotches on their body, Larry Bird or Nikola Jokic in their prime?
Jokic, I think. He slaps himself a little bit.
It looks like he's had a physical where he's had blood drawn, right, and he accidentally fell down the stairs.
Well, when you watch Jokic, though, I've done this comp before. Like, he looks like this sort of heavier kid that doesn't have any friends at recess, like in fifth or sixth grade, and he's bigger than everybody, but the cool kids still pick on him. And then he just decides, like, one day at recess, he's absolutely had it and starts beating the hell out of four kids at the same time. And he's red, and he has boogers coming down his nose.
And he's on Jokic. He ends up on one of the fight video accounts that Kyle follows.
Yeah, right. Those are still
30-second fights. Kyle loves us. That's big playground brawl today on 30-second fights.
That's definitely one of those things as you get older, you go, okay, I can't watch this.
I follow at least five of those accounts, and I actually think I have a better sense of what works and what doesn't work now if you're fighting somebody outside.
So you like, you're a better fighter just based on technique?
I feel like, yeah, if it ever happens, I know what – you don't want to go backwards. You don't want to keep your hands up like this. You want to be forward and fast.
Right.
That seems like what works.
It's like my bike
videos.
We'll
be back after this.
Oh, okay.
Wait, we got to talk about what Houston did. Sorry, Sean Yu. Houston traded – Clint Capela and Chris Paul and two first-round picks for Russell Westbrook, Robert Covington, and Jordan Bell.
And they got rid of Jordan Bell.
If you look at those two trades together, I think Chris Paul is the best player in the trade. I'd rather have him than Westbrook, the way Chris Paul's playing this year. They basically got the second and fourth best players in the trade because I think Capela is more valuable than Covington. So out of the four players they got the second and fourth best players this season and gave up two first-round picks. And now they have no size. I think it's idiotic. I don't understand it. I don't know if the owner is telling Daryl to do this stuff. This stuff is so – those trades are so uncharacteristic of how Daryl has built that team since 06. We're just throwing away first-round pick. Daryl hoarded first-round picks like the fucking uncut gemstone that KG had. He never wanted to trade first-round picks unless it was a shitty one. He certainly didn't want to not put protections on them and all the shit they did.
He was the guy that was coming up with, like, middle protection. Like, Daryl was inventing stuff.
Yeah, he was inventing stuff to not get burned on a first-round pick. And Covington, who in a Celtics-Sixers playoff series 2 years ago, was one of the MVPs for the Celtics. Because it was like, can you – I really hope Covington shoots this time and the ball doesn't go to the guys who are the good offensive players. And then he turns into this – alleged massive asset, which I agree he's good defensively, but that seems like a sideways move to me at worst. I don't get it.
Okay, I don't think there's anyone who knows Daryl, and he'll never admit it because he works for people, and he's never told me this. Like, as you and I joke about, it's not like we're that close.
Yeah, you guys are almost feuding.
Yeah.
It's like a borderline feud.
There will never be anyone that will convince me that he wanted to trade for Russell Westbrook and that contract. It just doesn't make any sense. Like, hey, Daryl, who do you want? You know who I'm really looking forward to adding to this team is somebody that's like a massive, like, historic high usage guy that's getting less efficient, who can't shoot. When everything is about shooting now and my whole roster is about shooting, I want to add a guy that can't shoot. And we can talk about off-ball cuts and all this stuff, but Harden and Westbrook are two of the least interested off-ball players that are really good that I've ever seen. Like, once they're off the ball, it's like, I don't want to do this. So I don't think that was a Daryl call at all. I think he said all the right things. That's my educated guess. And then with this, I'm sure there's still another thing to drop here for Houston to add some kind of big depth post-Capela.
Good luck.
But I imagine that they just thought, hey, we're just going to keep spreading this whole thing out. But I do think it's a fair question to ask. Like, has Covington become kind of overrated through all this?
Oh, 100%.
Right?
100%.
Like, he was
Go
nice.
Go watch the Philly-Boston series 2 years ago. He was a detriment to their team.
Right, and when's the last time like
he's,
he really
by the way,
stood
he's
out?
Almost 30. He's 29.
Yeah, this kind of feels a little bit like Gerald Wallace, but Gerald Wallace was like filthy at one point.
I'm so jealous of that. If you had tweeted that, I would have stolen that for the podcast and pretended I didn't see your Twitter. That's a really good one. Can I ask you this? Oh, there's another trade.
Oh.
Georgie Dang Georgie going to Memphis for James Johnson.
James Johnson on another team.
I like that Georgie Dang. I thought he was a guy I was kind of secretly hoping the Celtics would get, and I couldn't figure out the contracts because I like that he's an expiring next year. But his stats weren't bad this year. I actually thought he played half decently next to Towns.
Yeah, and he's been mad in Minnesota for a long time.
Can we talk about the Dave Jacoby trust triangle for a second? One of Jacoby's great theories of all time.
Sure.
I've stolen liberally. There's three people, and they all know each other really well. At some point, two of the people's loyalties is going to surpass the third person.
Okay.
So let's take me, Jalen, and Jacoby, for example. I was very close to both of those guys. That's a tough one because I think we all kind of trusted each other. But let's take, like, me, you, and Kyle.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm actually related to Kyle by marriage.
Right.
Trust triangle. If you tell Kyle something, odds are he's going to tell me.
Yeah, I knew that.
But you know that.
Yeah.
But some people, you might overpower, you might empower Kyle, be like, hey, don't tell Bill this. But he's still going to tell me because I win the trust triangle between the three of us. Trust triangle, Daryl Morey, Tillman Fertitta, James Harden.
I can tell you who's third.
If Harden is telling the owner, we got to get Westbrook,
which
we'll
he
be
did.
Better off.
Which he did.
And then the two of them
right.
overpower Daryl in the trust triangle and is like, you got to do this. This is James wants this. It's very important to me. We make James happy. I think we should really go get Russell Westbrook. And Daryl's like, all right, I'll talk to Sam. Maybe they'll do a straight up. And Sam's like, I want some picks. And Daryl's like, well, we're not doing that. Goes back to the trust triangle. And they're like, no, you misunderstood. We want Russell Westbrook. And now he's giving up two first round picks in that deal.
One of the things he did say, though.
That's just a theory.
Which was just a.
Obviously, I'm friends with Daryl, but I've never talked to him about that. I swear on my kids.
Yeah, I don't. He wouldn't
just
share it
with me. Just a
theory
and some scuttlebutt around the league that maybe he didn't want to make that trade.
Well, because I don't think that he did. I don't feel like I have to hear from him directly that he was like, hey, actually, I didn't want to make that trade. And part of being a good employee would be never admitting it to you, his friend, anyway. But
well, we saw him in Vegas. He seemed pretty pessimistic. He's like, no, we're not doing.
What do you
trade.
Mean? When I told him they were going to trade Chris Paul, and he said we're not.
Yeah, and he was like, we just almost beat the best team in the league.
Yeah,
and we won 65 games 2 years ago. Why would I trade Chris Paul? He had a whole thing.
And by the way, the Westbrook deal, like you had to give up picks because Westbrook was considered the better player. Paul's injury history. Westbrook's never. I mean, look, he's had injuries, but like you feel like Westbrook's going to hold up, although his declining athleticism scares me, at least what we saw this year. But to be fair to Westbrook, like ever since it looked just abysmal, he has played better. He's had like a nice scoring run here. I don't know if this is real. It's tough to bet on those two guys in the playoffs, but he's $39 million, $41 million, $44 million, and then a player option for $47 million. So he's got that extra year. He has the extra year, and you gave up the first. But what Daryl, the one nice thing Daryl did say
I thought Paul had the luxury. No, oh, that's brutal.
No.
My God.
But Daryl was like, one thing you've been saying that I don't think makes you a total idiot, Russillo, was he goes, your whole thing on like how overrated the last, like the back end, the back third of the first round picks are. So, you know, that's something you're just seeing guys be like, all right, fine, like 27, yay. But GMs love going, oh, you know, we have two firsts coming in. You're like, okay, you're going to be drafting a kid from like Virginia Tech.
Look at the Celtics. They had three firsts last year. None of them played more than 12 minutes a game.
Yeah, they've had multiple years with these three picks, and you just go, oh my gosh, this is great. And then
speaking of the Celtics, Adam Himmelsbach, per league sources, the Celtics did not make a trade before the deadline.
Oh, 5 minutes passed. That's
yeah.
exciting.
Five minutes passed. Seems like a good time for a break. Pretend I took a commercial break. We're back. Can we talk about let's get that weird Cavs trade out of
yeah,
the way.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Pistons trade what I would call cap crap.
Yep. John Henson, 40-14. I don't know how old he is.
I think, wasn't he on the Louisville team with Purvis Ellison?
He's a North Carolina guy, but I think they played against
him. Was he on the North Carolina team with Rasheed Wallace and Vince Carter?
Yeah, he backed them up.
I honestly have no idea how long he's been in the league.
he's been around, but he has like a weird, like, young face with old hairline.
I went to a Celtics-Cavs game in Boston over the holidays, and I saw him, and I was like, John Henson.
Yeah, tell
me. What are you doing
here?
Did
you ever have a moment where you were like, if this guy just gets some more touches,
right,
he could be the next Thon Maker.
Yeah, string bean centers are going to come around. So Pistons get a bunch of crap. Cavs get Andre Drummond. They're going to put Andre Drummond together with Kevin Love and basically try to break the brain of anyone who's ever believed in any sort of modern basketball.
So Drummond, this one, this is all speculation here, okay? He's a 28.7 player option for next year. But we know
there's no free agents.
There's not many cap teams with cap space. And he just played on a bad team, and now he got traded to a worse one. I'm wondering if this is one of those deals where a front office is talking to the agent, and they go, hey, do you know what you want to do? Okay, well, how about you do this? How about you opt in? You give it another year. Drummond's still young enough. I watched the whole Drummond-Suns game last night because I wanted to watch he and Ayton. And it's just so funny.
Even I didn't do that.
Well, I was kind of ready for this.
This is where you go to another level than me. Where you're like,
Ayton Drummond.
Pistons, Suns.
I have notes. You want to look at some?
You're fucking chanters like, 26. The Pistons are playing the Suns?
Yeah. Like, ooh, Rubio is great for Ayton. Ayton cuts hard. It says it right there. But Drummond puts up these absurd numbers. Like, I just going through it. Like, 7 straight years, the number one offensive rebounding player in the league. He's on pace to be the number one rebounding player for the 5th straight year. He's been number one in defensive win shares twice. 3 years of 17-16. And his free throws are gone from like 30% to 60%. And yet you watch it and you go, he kind of just gets the ball and he looks around. And
it's tough.
You don't, like, would we have thought this guy was awesome in the 90s? Because this trade is like, oh, they got Drummond. Like, do you want him? And honestly, the Pistons got nothing for him, and it's only that 1 year. There has to be some understanding, Colby Altman and the agent here with Drummond, going like, what do you think your plan's going to be? And maybe we'll figure it out. I don't know.
This is where I'm glad I'm here. Because this is one of the few things I'm really good at, is tying in
conspiracies,
tying in useless NBA history from the past 50 years into a current player. There's always a center like this that puts up stats and you don't win with them. And you go back to like Walt Bellamy in the 1960s. It was like, Walt Bellamy, man, you look at those stats, man. He's putting up big numbers. And that there was this, I put this in my book. There was this writer, George Quesada, who was like the legendary. He was like the Woj of the 1960s.
No kidding.
And he said Walt Bellamy was the skeleton of the 20,000 point club. Was one of his lines about him. Because everyone during the 60s was like, well, that fucking guy, you're not winning with him. And it's like, you have Chamberlain, you have Russell, you have all these. And then it's like, you have Walt Bellamy. Teams are taking chances on him. I think the Knicks traded him for DeBuscher. And then they end up going on their whole run. But he's like, so you go through the rest of the decades, and it's like, yeah, in the 80s, it was Joe Barry Carroll.
We had early 80s, right?
We had Benoit Benjamin.
Benoit Benjamin.
Where you're like,
awesome.
Oh, man, you look at Benoit's per 36, and you go all the way through, and now it's Andre Drummond. I don't think he's a bad guy. I just don't think you can actually win basketball games if he's on your team as one of the three highest big guys.
Bellamy scored in his first.
You love this. Well, Bellamy. He was like 30 and 20 his rookie year.
Right, 61-62, the Chicago Packers.
Yeah, God bless.
And he was an Indiana guy. 31 and 20.
As a rookie.
28 and 16. 27 and 17. The rebounding numbers, though, when you go back to that era,
yeah,
as you know.
Clearly out of whack.
Like, the shot attempts, how quickly they brought it down. Like, pace has definitely picked back up, and I want to go back and compare some of that stuff. But, like, anytime I look at rebounding numbers from that era, you go, okay, well, this is just.
It's completely out of whack.
Yeah.
But the Drummond thing, I just don't know. If he's going to be expensive, there's no recipe to him helping an actual playoff team. Like a real team that has a chance to go a couple rounds. If he's $8 million a year, if he's Montrezl Harrell money, if he's like in the Zubac spot making $7 million a year for 3 years, great. But the problem with these guys is he's not going to make that because somebody's going to be dumb enough to go, yeah, all right, 75 for three.
Yeah,
let's
sign it up.
And where are you going? What should you do that?
In today's game too, man. I mean, I look at it and go, like, would he work on any team? Like, would he work, you know, $27 million is a totally different thing, but would he be a plus? Like, you run down that resume as I was looking at it last night. I'm like, there's so many great. Like, if you're the GM and you're introducing him, you have that whole thing rehearsed. You can't wait to say all those things. That was like Chris Wallace when they traded for Vin Baker, and he goes, against the East, he was a 21-12 guy. And immediately I go home, barely had internet that worked, and I went through it, and I was like, that was against 16 teams. I was so pissed. I was like, you misled us, Chris Wallace.
Unfortunately, it was 21 beers and 12 shots. He had his stats wrong. The no trades for the Indiana Pacers, no trades for the Oklahoma City Thunder. I should mention that. The Oklahoma City thing's important because a lot of people thought Miami was getting Gallinari. Well, I want to talk about them in 1 second.
We have to do Miami here.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's put a bow on the Cavs, though. I just don't know what this Kobe Altman. Well, I remember when he got hired and it was like a lot of great hire Twitter with the writers. I just think he's been bad. I don't really agree with anything he's done.
I think
maybe it
Gilbert.
Is all Gilbert. I don't know, but Gilbert's been in the hospital the last 9 months. I don't know how involved he is anymore. There doesn't seem any rhyme or reason to the team they're putting together. They have these two guards that I don't think can play together.
I don't blame them for drafting when they did with the two guys and thinking like, hey, we have two guys that can probably create their own and get a shot going, and they're both athletic, but they're – like, it's a bad duplication
and the
of what they are.
The Love contract, which I defended at the time.
I
I'll
didn't.
Take the loss on it. Yeah. I was like, well, he's an asset. You
they
can
did
flip
it for
him.
PR. It
no,
felt
for
like
PR,
more...
but it's like, well, they can flip that. At some point, they'll be able to trade
but
him.
But this has been one of the biggest disconnects in the league. If you talk to guys, it's like, wait a minute.
I didn't know.
We're giving, like, we're hooking you up by taking Love's contract. And Cleveland Forever was like, I mean, one of my favorite things I heard this summer, like, on Beeline System, like, Love, you're going to get a lot for him. Like, people forget he's even on the team now.
I had Celtics fans in my life texting me, like, you think we could get Love for Hayward?
I wouldn't do that.
I wouldn't do that in 10 million years. Where's Kevin Love? Where's he going to play? Is he going to be the five? And I think there's these guys that just have trouble fitting in with the way basketball is being played now. And he's one of them. Drummond's another one. And they basically doubled down and were like, ah.
But Love's like a really good example of some of these guys that we absolutely adore because of the stats. And then you go, okay, well, what's happening here?
Well, and going back to Minnesota, he's your best guy. You're not winning ever.
And his numbers were insane.
Yeah.
The rebounding numbers. Then he starts stretching the floor. I mean, he was – and then Rambis is like in the beginning. Remember what they did with him? Like, okay, that's great. You're scoring all these points. You have all these rebounds, but you don't defend, and we're not closing the game with you there.
Yeah.
And then they didn't give him the extra year. I mean, we're doing a Kevin Love biopic here. But
I think it's interesting that he wanted to get traded 2 months ago, and they literally could not trade him.
Yeah, people were like, no, we're doing you the favor. Like, you're not trading us an asset. We're taking this off
so
your
I
hands.
Didn't, I had never heard that. I listened to our friends Windhorst and Zach a couple days ago, and Windhorst was talking about their shopping Love, like, we'll take a first and an expiring. And teams were telling them, no, you'll give us the first if we're taking that. We're not taking that unless you give us something. And I thought that's a pretty big loss for Kevin Love. Okay, let's talk about.
By the way, I just think it's worth mentioning, like, because Kevin Love the next 2 years is 31.229. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're still at 60 million plus.
I know what you're saying, and what you're saying is yikes.
Yeah, that's hey, look, we're just trying to feed the kids info.
It's a trade piece that, like, Michael Jordan peak. Terrible Michael Jordan trade would have been like, we'll take him. It's good. How about some expirings for him? I'll throw in a first. I'll protect it. Top five. We didn't give up too much. And now you have this guy who's basically Nick Batum clogging up here. It's too bad. And I don't think this is necessarily Kevin Love's fault, but sometimes when you're that expensive, you've basically priced yourself out of being on a good team, because any good team is going to want to be paying $29 million for a top three that actually helps them win the title, you know. And then you think back to one of the most interesting, I think, fork in the road moments of the last decade was Golden State with the Klay Thompson, Kevin Love thing.
It's unbelievable, right?
It's like he honestly did a documentary about it. Sets up the next 5 years of NBA history and how split people were, not just like publicly. I thought they should have done it. But internally, where you had these two groups and you had one side saying, do not trade Klay Thompson, him and Steph together, this is where basketball is going. And the other side, like, Kevin Love, 25-13, put him in with Steph, pick and rolls.
Yeah. No, we need a front court. We have some depth. And, you know, you remember Klay, like, as much as, like, the Siakam story is amazing, Obviously, Giannis and another level like Butler and Kawhi. Like, I always feel like guys that are great right away. But we've had a nice handful of players who are like some of the best players in this game where you go, it took a lot longer for these guys to develop. That's not normally how it works out.
Yeah.
But Clay, to a lesser degree, I think is overlooked in his improvement because he had a stretch there where it looked like he could not actually dribble. Like, everything was
– very.
Yeah, and everything he got was dependent upon somebody else getting him set up. Now, he got better at handling, but I think one of the things that I know that I made a mistake with on him was that, you know how amazing that is that you can score 30 and dribble seven times? Like, some of these numbers that he's had over his career,
yeah,
like, he had 40 on 11 dribbles. Like, what do you – like, that's insane.
I mean, what did he have, 60 and three quarters or 58?
61 and three quarters, and I sent a tweet about how mad I was when they benched him.
Miami, it seems like they're only ending up with Justice Winslow for Iguodala. It seems like – Jackson, is that right? Is that how this netted out?
Yeah, Kevin tweeted basically that they couldn't agree on the Gallo deal because –
Kevin Costner?
Kevin Costner tweeted about it.
Yeah.
So they wanted to re-sign Gallo for an extra year. Didn't happen. I was shocked when I saw this trade for a couple reasons, and then all of a sudden I realized what happened. So I'm going to walk through that process really quick.
Don't take a long time to do
it. No, I'm going to go quick. I think Iguodala is at a really dangerous stage of his career physically, and I thought he broke down the last two seasons, and I don't think he's the asset people seem to think he is. I think he's a great guy to have. He's certainly not somebody I would trade Justice Winslow for. The counter with Winslow is that he has trouble staying on the court. They're just, for whatever reason, you can't keep them together for 8 months. I thought it was an incredible deal for Memphis, where you have this guy who doesn't want to be there anyway. I'd much rather have a guaranteed guy under a good contract than the 22nd pick in the draft or whatever you're being offered. I didn't understand why Miami did this, and then I understood. So short-term, Riley thinks they have a chance maybe to sneak out of the East. And if Iguodala is resembling the old Iguodala, great. That's going to be a better asset for them in Winslow. More importantly, in the piece that I'm not sure people have hammered enough, he gets out of the third year of Winslow's deal. I think Miami has been thinking about summer 2021 this whole time. They want to get to 2021 with Jimmy Butler's deal under contract. That's it. He's going to be making 35, 36, 38 million. I don't remember what it is. I think they want to go for Giannis, and I think they want to go for Oladipo. Those would be my top two picks for them and whoever else is available in 2021. But I think this is about Giannis and about knowing that if you're going to try to get Giannis, he needs to be with a second guy. Whoever that is, it's Oladipo, or who are the other free agents available in 2021?
There's
some great ones. But to get Giannis, you need him to have his buddy cop guy that goes with him, and you already have Butler in place. And Winslow making $13 million that summer is a problem, and they could have gotten rid of that contract now, gives them more flexibility, the whole thing. So I think that's what they were thinking.
All right, Winslow's played 11 games this year. And the only time he's ever really looked sort of unlocked is when he played point guard.
Last year.
That has been the best stretch of numbers that I've seen from him. And I think we've all fell in love with, like, what Winslow could be. But, you know, if we do a part two of that NBA support group thing, like, Winslow would be a candidate for somebody being like, maybe it's time for me to give up here. So
I know the smart teams are on him.
Yeah, but
– because there's some advanced metric shit with him and in how he fits in with the other guys that I think is actually really positive for him. Like, when he's playing, when he's healthy, I do think he's an asset. But you're
Kawhi
right.
And George can opt out. Gordon Hayward's up. Conley. I mean, you know, I'm going through some of these guys. That's the Anthony Davis thing, depending on how
Oladipo.
He does the extension. And Oladipo, it was good to see him back last night in an epic collapse against Toronto. And people got to understand, like, hey, Toronto's going to play their asses off those last couple minutes. They're going to press you. Like, you got to put in some anti-press stuff. You know, like, you ever watch a college game where you're like, did you guys never practice against the press? And it sounds funny that it happens to NBA guys.
Yeah.
But it's the whole zone thing. If you played zone all the time, you'd get killed eventually. You would. But when you do it to just screw somebody up, it really is. I don't care if you're 25 or 27 and a bunch of years in the league, it messes you up. Like, okay, don't dribble to the corner. You know, throw it back middle, throw it backwards, swing it to the other side. And, like, the Pacers melted down. I want to see Oladipo get back to what he was where, you know, he's had some shooting stretches here where they haven't been great. I'm not necessarily holding that against him, but before
I think it's
a
strange fit
with him and all those other guys.
Well, because they really established a nice offensive chemistry without him.
They're really fun to watch.
I think the way Brogdon runs that team, the last time we were here together, I picked him for the All-Star team.
Yeah, and then Sabonis, and you look at, like, you
and
know, Miles is always
guys
a little
in the right spots.
Yeah, but. Like, watching them last night, thinking they were going to get that win against Toronto, and Toronto goes an 11-0 run to close the game, I'm thinking, this is a nice win from this group, man. This is a really nice win. Now, granted, Norman Powell's out, but then, like, Terrence Davis steps up.
I want to talk about Indiana in a second.
Wait a minute. Where were we? We were talking about Justice Winslow
in Miami. And
I don't think it matters for Miami. Because, look, the fact that Duncan Robinson is who he is, watching that guy cut off the ball, like, there's high school coaches in Indiana right now that canceled Pornhub.
Right.
And they're like, I'm going to watch this instead.
Or they're searching Pornhub for Duncan Robinson.
That Kendrick Nunn is a little bit like Lou Williams is my hero, okay?
Yeah.
There's a little of Nunn where you're like, but the fact that he is that is insane. And then the fact that Hero, who kind of looked like the odd man out early on, like, the Heat have added, if you include Butler and Bam's improvement, Bam's gone from, like, hey, nice little guy, to I can't believe the decisions that he makes as a guy playing the five in this game. That's like five new dudes that all help this team out right now, and that's where I think they look at Winslow going, yes. But your Iguodala concern is probably fair, too.
Well, I think they obviously decided Winslow wouldn't be playing crunch time for them in a playoff game.
No chance. I mean, he's not playing now.
Iguodala gives them the veteran, the potential lockdown guy. I'm just really dubious that he's going to help them. I think first of all, he's 36 years old.
I'm going to
look it up,
too.
Ton of miles on him. I think he's got, like, what? He's got, like, over 1,100 regular season games and over 140 or 150 playoff games. And those playoff games, I always count as, like, 1.5. Every playoff game counts as 1.5 games because they're so intense.
I started to think, too, and, yeah, no, it was happening the last couple of years. And I'll go through the game logs here.
I just think that's a tough position to keep going at a high level when you're 36 with all the shit that he's gone through and the various injuries he's had. To expect him to swing a 2 playoff series for you seems a little unrealistic, but
I felt like he became somebody who, like, as a 3-point shooter
trade. Oh, congratulations, J.R. Smith and Darren Collison. Two more guys who think they should play on the Lakers.
Collison, like, that had been out there whether it was going to be the Clippers
or
the Lakers.
So they waived Rondo?
That's been bad. The Rondo stuff.
I feel like I know basketball really well. I did not see the Rondo second half of his career just turning into, like, kind of not really an asset stage happening.
Yeah, but remember when, like, he had that 40 revival, though,
know,
with New Orleans? And you're like, wait a minute. And that was kind of the Rondo thing. It's like, you think everybody's critical of you. You just proved how much you mail it in at times. I mean, he even on his way out of Boston was like, you know, I didn't really play defense the last couple of years.
Yeah, admitted it.
You would just admitted it. I thought physically he was moving around really well at the beginning of the year. Watching Lakers games, I'm like, look at this guy.
Is he like guard Roy Hibbert? Where the league just moved against him in this really dramatic way and reduced. This guy in 2010 was the best player in a series with LeBron James in a back-to-back MVP year. He outplayed LeBron James in a playoff series and sent him home packing. Rajon Rondo.
Remember his
Bulls
series?
It's not like he was, like, just good.
Right.
Remember the Bulls series? He was fucking awesome.
Before that, he was unbelievable.
What about 2012? Like, he was the best player on that team. That team almost made the finals. I don't understand it. I mean, I understand it because I know the math has moved a certain way and who knows, but it's weird. Since the knee injury, was never really able to recapture where he was.
But for somebody that everybody's always like, look how smart he is. I mean, he was somebody last year that just, he becomes so defiant. Like, Rick Carlisle, who's probably one of the smartest guys that probably does the most with the least more often than not.
Yeah.
Like, I look back to the Mavs record last year, I'm like, how the hell did that team win that many games? And other people just go, look, Rick's that good. And Rondo completely checked out on him. And then last year it was like a mutiny against Luke. And then Rondo sits down in the stands. And then he, like, got pissed at everybody for pointing out that that's kind of a beat move. Like, why are you doing that? Like, you're clearly showing him up. You've been in this league a long time. I mean, that goes all the way back to Kentucky, that as talented as Rondo was, he was somebody that was always a little difficult to get along with. So now when you see the decline in play, I had a moment in the beginning of this year where I thought, oh, okay, this makes sense. And LeBron's always liked him. Like, LeBron's always wanted to play with him, always liked him a lot, and that's why they brought him back.
He does definitely want a couple of those role guys that aren't going to be like, I can't believe I'm playing with LeBron James.
Yeah, right.
Right?
Hey, so can I have your cell phone number?
He's like that. Boogie's kind of like right. that.
But like Caruso, FaceTime, he hammered again.
Well, Jarrett Smith's like, they could be hanging out at 3 in the morning, and Jarrett Smith could look at LeBron and be like, I just want you to know something. I feel like I was every bit as good as you were. And he would be serious.
Yeah.
He was like, you know what? I just feel like I should get more credit for 2016. Like, he would honestly believe that.
But do you guys want to watch my McDonald's high school game again?
I was fucking great in high school.
His McDonald's game is one of the all-timers.
The Miami thing, I don't think they did enough. I thought they were on the fringes if they could have pulled off the Gallinari thing. And I think it's really interesting that they wouldn't agree to an extension with him, because that goes back to my Giannis theory.
I think you're overrating
all
Winslow.
In on Giannis.
Look, maybe the Winslow thing works in Memphis, no pressure, you're away from all that stuff. But it's not like Winslow is going to have the ball in his hands a ton with Ja. They cleared the money off of that. They changed the way they did the contract structure with Iguodala. I think they want a guy that's a bit more of a warrior, even though I think Iguodala became kind of like a marginal closeout guy towards the end, where there were Warriors, where before it's like you got to make sure you get a hand in his face. And sometimes you're like, all right, maybe we'll let him take a couple and kind of see where he's at tonight. He should be rested. He should be good to go. And if it protects their future thing, and you throw in Jay Crowder, who I feel like everybody's like, we got Jay Crowder. Maybe doesn't work out.
He's a little Marcus Morrissey, where he actually, when you have him, you go, hey, this guy's good.
Yeah.
Didn't realize.
Yeah.
And then he takes the biggest shot of the game with 40 seconds left. And you're like, what the fuck just happened?
No.
And why did he take that?
Winslow just wasn't going to play in this rotation. So it's a deep team. I like what Miami did. And yet I would... You know, these buyout guys, we get really excited about them. Like, remember Damon Stoudemire towards the end? It's like, oh, the Spurs got him.
So, buyout guys, I had this as a list. Reggie Jackson, possibly?
He's done, right? He's
Tristan Thompson?
Tristan would be – like, I haven't always been the biggest Tristan fan, but I'm telling you, like, I'm still so impressed with the way that guy moves around.
When I went to that Celtics game, I was like, this is exactly the kind of guy who would be awesome in the Celtics. He rebounds and he rolls to the rim with his hands up, and which is basically what Tice does too.
Yeah, but I love
those guys succeed on the Celtics.
Like, which bigs can you keep on the floor in certain playoff matchups? Like, can he switch on to smaller guys?
Who have been in big games.
Right, and he's that guy. I don't know. I think he's a guy that can put up some numbers, but I don't know that he's ever been – he's shooting it better this year.
Can I take a victory lap?
From three. He's terrible overall. Yeah.
I've been saying for 4 months that Tristan Thompson was a buyout candidate, and I keep getting emails from Cavs fans like, fuck you.
You're going to get
a number one.
Yeah.
That's bullshit. Well, now they just traded for Andre Drummond, and they probably signed him to an extension. Guess who's getting bought out at the end of February? Tristan Thompson. They'll save money. They'll dump him, and he's going to become easily the most important buyout guy.
I wonder.
Don't you think
he's still with Clutch? Right, he's got to be. I mean, they hooked him up with that incredible deal. I'm just thinking.
Hooked him up is one way to put it.
Here's what I'm asking though.
Clippers. Now that's somebody on the Clippers. He's crunch time fire for the Clippers.
Okay, but do they? Does he end up on the Clippers?
To defy LeBron?
Yeah.
I mean, if he wants to play in crunch time, he should go to the Celtics. That would be my advice to Tristan Thompson.
I want to see it just for another lame Cantor tweet.
Pretending he's happy with it, but then you find out in minute 48 on his podcast that he's kind of bummed out.
Like, anybody that's ever watched any Celtics games goes, all right, they need another big. Like, they just need – like, Tice is a nice player. Cantor has his moments.
Can I push back on that?
You think they're good?
No, I don't.
Because, look, they're better than the Sixers have been.
I do like the Cantor-Tice combo. I think they need a third guy because I'm worried about injury and I'm worried about foul trouble.
Right, but, like, Cantor, anytime somebody says, like, they need help up front, like, acts like it's this, you know, active.
He's personally insulted by it.
He's just like, okay, I get it.
I would like to see them get another person. So we don't think Miami did enough. Do we think Philly did enough? They added Alec Burks and Big Dog Jr., gave up a couple second-rounders, got Golden State some tax relief. Alec Burks was good this year.
Alec Burks is somebody,
really surprised Golden State didn't keep him.
Alec Burks is somebody that you get for a couple weeks, and you're like, wow, how do we get this guy?
Yeah, he's amazing.
Yeah, he's been on three teams now in a very short amount of time. I think they were desperate. I think they were desperate to add any kind of scoring depth. The weird thing is like sometimes I think that they do have depth, but we know their biggest issue. And I went through all the numbers now. Whatever the offensive thing is, like they're splitting up Simmons and Embiid more now, and it's always weird tracking those minutes because Embiid misses time. So it's like what percentage of Simmons' minutes are by himself when Embiid's healthy and which percentage is it when he's not
awkward.
Playing. But now like they went from – I forget what the number is. Like their per 100 possession 3 years ago was pretty good with the two of them on the floor.
Yeah.
Then it got worse, and now it's like almost below average offensively. And then there's Horford and Embiid pairing numbers that are brutal.
You left out the part that there's suddenly like a lot of Shake Milton.
Well, that's because Richardson's been out. I don't know how many games in a row.
I just saying maybe I would have maybe. I just felt like and maybe Burks. Maybe they think he can kind of be the pseudo. Point guard spot with Simmons as the actual point guard, but I don't know. That team seems pretty flawed to me.
When they're bad, it's so – I mean, we already know this with them, but would you pick them – I mean, would you pick the Celtics against them if it's a 6-3 matchup?
No.
Because I wouldn't. I'd pick Philly.
More talent. But the frustrating part is
– Is it more talent or is it just that a
– It's just more high ceiling.
And I know what happened in the last game, and Boston was great in that game defensively with the way they doubled.
Embiid had just come back. Right. They were throwing stuff at him. But I think the tragedy of this is that they were so much fun when Embiid wasn't there. And it, like, unlocked Simmons. If I was a GM, you're thinking this summer, if this becomes panic town, one of these guys has to go kind of stuff, I'd watch those 8 games. You'd be like, could I build a high-powered offense around this guy? I actually think the answer is yes. And I said it before in a previous pod we did. It's a little Lamar Jackson-y. Like, you have to construct an offense that fits what he does. But I think if you did it, he's going to score 20 and get 12 and 13 every night, basically, with the right team and the right kind of usage rate.
Yeah, the Heat game was bad. And then we'll see.
The Heat game was, like, kind of dangerous to me.
In what
because
way?
That's a team that they destroyed earlier in the season. It's a pretty big game. You got your guys back. You already got embarrassed on a Saturday night. And you get your ass kicked by Miami.
Yeah.
Like, that game is over in the second quarter.
Yeah. I mean, there's always a little bit of a run now. But, like, they were doing some two-man stuff where they were attacking, like, an Embiid-Simmons switch. I mean, they only did it a couple times. And I saw it, and I'm like, oh, man, like, Miami's so crisp. Like, everything they do is crisp purpose, you know? And I kind of felt like that way about the Pacers a little bit last night. But I'm like, Philly's just going like, what? Like, Philly would be trying to figure out what the switch was or where it was going or what the handoff was. And it was like, before you guys even recognized what the hell was going on, the shot was up.
Well, that's a good conversation. Teams that just – because we're at 50 games now. This is where you're pretty much who you are at this point, especially now trade deadline. The teams that just – when you watch them, you're just like, oh, yeah. They're good. Toronto, Indiana.
Toronto, big time.
I think Miami most nights. Yeah. They remind me of that.
They're a little weird on the road, not as bad as Philly. What's Philly, like 9-18
weirdly,
on the road
Memphis,
now?
No, just the teams that know who they are and night to night, they're going to do what they do. I think Dallas, when Doncic is healthy, it's a team that knows what it is. And you go down the line, there's a lot of them. And I mention this because when Philly has all their guys, I don't feel like they know who they are. I don't think they know. First of all, the first check mark on the box is Embiid feeling it tonight?
Yeah.
He's not? All right, what's our plan B?
How much is he getting doubled? Like, he needs to do, and I know it's the hand a little bit, but he needs to do a better job, and he was always so good at this. Like, the thing that I thought made him special as a post player is, like, he had good awareness to skip it and everything, but he'll have these moments, especially late, and that's kind of the knock against Embiid. Like, should you give him all these touches? Well, you should because he's really good, but how well does he do against some of these doubles, stagger double, like, hey, I'm not going to double you on the catch. I'm going to double you on the dribble, you know, and it's like, all right, it screws me up. And then if you don't have shooting around it, like, what am I doing, passing it back out to Ben Simmons?
My favorite fake trade was Conley for Tobias Harris. Utah wins a trade. Philly gets out of that Harris contract and hopes Conley's rejuvenated as their real point guard.
Is Tobias Harris taller than Willie Barton?
Willie.
Yeah. I like to call him Willie Barton.
Tobias Harris.
If you can drop 50, your name should be Willie.
Can you read Tobias Harris's contract to our audience?
Yeah, I would hate to for Philly fans. I get why they did it, though. You know. I do. Who else did I want to compare him to? I sent you a text on this the other night. Taller Willie Barton or more expensive
Jay Crowder?
No, no, no. Not
Jay
Crowder.
Oh, my God. Look at all these texts from GMs. mate, this joke, it's actually been built up too much now, so we're gonna pass.
Look at all these jokes from GMs.
No, no. I had a taller Willie Barton or more expensive somebody else. So I think there was a comp there. So I'm doing two things at once.
I'm gonna audible while you're looking this up.
Yep.
I personally don't think Philly did enough, but there you go.
Well, I don't know what they were gonna do. I mean, are they gonna trade Horford?
Can we talk about Atlanta getting Clint Capela and Dwayne Dedman?
Yeah, they got
big.
To go
with John Collins?
They got big.
What's the purpose?
By the way, Tobias Harris, $35 million, then $36 next year, $37.6, and then an almost $40 million. That's 23-24. And I had heard, like, Tobias is like, look, I just, all right, that's cool. I'll take this, and then we'll figure it out later.
Tobias is like, he's getting read the numbers. He's like, 40 in year four?
Yeah. 40 total? Oh, 40 in the fourth.
If I say yes right now, they can't back out, right?
And remember, like, he wasn't going to take, like, those extensions where it's like, well, you can take it now or make way more later on. Atlanta.
Atlanta. Yeah. That Clint Capela and Dwayne Dedman, who has two more years on his contract after this one and who is just demonstrably unhappy.
He tried
to make our all miserable first team.
He's a backup.
It was too crowded. We made him a backup. Apologies to him. But yeah, so I don't know what Atlanta's doing. I don't know what to make of anything they're doing except for that Trae Young's been playing really well for them. Shout out to him.
Can I ask
He's feisty night after night after night. He's a fucking handful. I still don't
He gets
know.
Officiated like he's been playing 10 years in the league.
It's
though.
Unbelievable.
I can't believe the calls
oh,
that
man,
he gets.
Now the Trae Youngites are going to come
out. No, it's all right. No, it's fair.
The Traithers?
Did you just come up with that?
Yeah, I just did right now.
That's good.
The Traithers?
You're back. Is Bill Simmons back?
I'm fucking back. Got that Swedish blood running through me. I'm feeling great. So the Traithers.
Yeah, that's good. You should make a shirt.
Traithers?
Yeah.
Can we make that a shirt? Get on that, guys. Okay,
make
good.
It like an off-white hoodie, and the kids are going to love it. Off-white was huge in South Beach this week.
Off-white's great. The Clippers went for it.
They
made those awesome LA Clippers sweatshirts. Ben Simmons has a Clippers sweatshirt that he wears, not because I like the Clippers, because it's a cool sweatshirt. Wanted to make that clear.
Do you think that Ben Simmons will last longer with Embiid, or your Ben Simmons will last longer with you?
Who's going to play more years with them going forward? I don't know. It's dicey.
I feel like you have a longer-term deal with your Ben.
The Simmons family still roots for Philly Ben Simmons.
Do you?
Yeah, we do.
That surprises me.
I was worried for about a year that he might be the next LeBron James, and that would be weird for my son. But now it's in a great spot. He just has the same name as a frustratingly talented. And
you guys
awesome
had like a cute little Twitter thing going on when he
we
was
did.
In college.
I was rooting for him. Yeah. I didn't like when he laid over in the LSU season.
I don't think he really did. That season was a mess.
He kind of.
Yeah, but if you have that many rebounds, you're not some guy that's not putting in effort. I thought it was like four guys that all thought they were the guy. There were all these wings. The coaching wasn't terrific. Whatever.
I have an incredibly important question for you.
That's your LSU recap from 4 years
ago. Do you think you could hold this podcast alone for 3 minutes while I go pee?
Yeah. Yeah, I think I can do
okay.
that.
Okay. This is great. Guys, we're making history right now. Russillo solo.
I'm still trying to find that. That joke that's just not going to be funny enough to go ahead and do this. So I guess that's it for the trades. I just wanted to do a quick recap on the Mookie Betts trade. So it's two players, Verdugo's, who's just one guy. And anytime you can sign or trade for a reliever that weighs 270-plus and has already had a blown-out elbow for 2-plus years, you obviously have to go ahead and make that trade. This is the Mookie segment, though, for all the baseball writers out there that are far smarter than I am about this because you remind us all the time. If the best you can do is Verdugo and a prospect who's already blown out his elbow, there's a really good chance you can do that well again during the All-Star break. And that was talking baseball. I want to talk Celtics when Bill isn't here just to bum him out a little bit and be like, oh, what did I miss? Do I need something? No, Davis Bertans is not somebody you just give away. I had heard Philly was hot on him, but Philly didn't really have a lot of trade assets outside of their main guys. And a lot like Philly has this thing where I guess you could still kind of hold out hope that if everybody's playing together all at the same time and you figure out these rotations. I don't know. Look, I picked them to come out of the East. Philadelphia is easily the most disappointing team in the NBA. I don't really know how that's even debatable. I guess you could say Houston a little bit, but obviously you guys know that I'm not the biggest Rockets guy in California. But the Celtics, this rotation, this turnover of guys never being – do you remember when Wu-Tang toured with Rage Against the Machine? I think it was in the late 90s. I don't think any of the staffers here are going to remember that. But at one point, Wu-Tang and Rage toured together. And what ended up happening was when you saw Wu-Tang, you didn't know who was going to show up. Like, Wu-Tang would just – no. I'm comparing the Boston Celtics to Wu-Tang when they toured with Rage Against the Machine. So what happened was, like, they canceled – I think they ended up canceling this whole tour. 97. Yeah, 97, because I remember that because it was the year I was supposed to graduate. And – they were like, all right, enough. Because, like, Wu-Tang was 10 deep, 13 deep. And they thought, like, look, if six of us show up, that's still sort of like getting Wu-Tang.
Yeah.
And yet the Celtics feel a little bit like that. I'd like to see a 20-game stretch where all those guys play together. My Tatum ceiling was revisited probably a month or so ago where I
Tatum, the true believers, and even I wavered last year, it's –
so you think it's good now? It's like he's no more doubt of Tatum is allowed. Because you know what stat? I'm just going to – sorry. I have to finish this part.
Go.
There was a stat. I think it was – he's like, hey, his longest stretch ever of 20-plus points per game, six games, doubling his previous longest stretch. And I go, that's great, but isn't that a little weird that in his third year he had never had more than three games in a row with 20 points?
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
That's what I feel good about. I think
– this is it. He's turned the corner.
I think he has elevated his ability to finish from 8 feet and in, which was the flaw in his game. He would either lose the ball. Last year, it's like his ball handling wasn't great, or he'd make like the perfect move and the ball would go off the backboard, or he'd roll in and out.
Twanitis.
It's starting to happen. I'm just telling you. Starting to happen.
So this is it. So he is going to be the face of a franchise on a good team.
Sometimes when he would drive to the basket, it was like it had never happened in his life before, the way he would, you know, he'd go a little too fast. Or, like, now there's, like, a calm about him when he's doing some of this stuff that's starting to look a little T-Mac-ish.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah. My big thing with him is, like, if he's just never going to be able to finish, you're never going to be a great scorer. What we're starting to see
with
him
is the
finishing.
There's no way he shouldn't be able to finish.
And he can go left or right. He's got long-ass Spider-Man arms. Some bad news. The Clippers will not be keeping Isaiah Thomas.
Jeez. Do you remember the Isaiah Thomas thing? Look, if we would do a quick revisit of the Isaiah Thomas timeline, what he did for Boston was incredible. I still think people have to understand that, like, the second best offensive player on the team was Avery Bradley, so everything was set up for Isaiah. Every single possession, high screen roll, but he did it. He produced. And they beat that Wizards team that they probably shouldn't have beaten. I mean, that was like, when you looked at that Wizards team, you go, you guys are just mentally not tough enough. I'm not saying like Kyrgios mentally soft, but close to it. Tennis reference. And so whenever
my favorite male tennis player.
Oh, are you serious?
I'm always, it's like watching somebody walk on the third rail of a subway.
But you're a big McEnroe guy, right?
No, right now. The guy I like watching the most is Kyrgios. I'm just rooting for him to put it together, and I know he never will.
Yeah. I don't. Well, maybe
he's just going to melt down in a match at some point. And each time I watch, I'm like, this is the time he's not going to melt down. Yeah. And then he melts down.
No, you're right, though, because there's like, okay, that's the point you lost, and now you're going to break something. Now you're going to yell. And it's everybody else's
fault. And now
you're
going to lose the next 11 points.
And the thing that sucks about tennis is if you're mentally soft, you can't hide.
No.
Like, there's guys playing in games all the time that we don't really get to notice. Like, oh, because football, there's a million dudes out there. Basketball a little bit here or there.
Golf's like that too, by the way. If you bogey 15,
I remember
and you're
a guy,
just shot for the last three holes because you had a bogey.
The Red Sox in 03 after the fact when they had that Yankee series. We all know the game. The Boone walk-off.
Yeah.
They traded Mookie Betts this week, by the way. He was like, I would sit there and pray the ball wasn't hit to me. You imagine being a major leaguer, like a good one. And you're like, I just don't want the ball hit to me in Yankee Stadium.
We're ending the podcast with Mookie Betts. I have a tweet to read from you, from Andre Drummond.
To me?
he just did this tweet to the world.
Oh.
If there's one thing I learned about the NBA, there's no friends or loyalty.
So that was a good clubhouse.
I've given my heart and soul to the Pistons, and to be have this happen, typo, to be have this happen with no heads up makes me realize even more that this is just a business, exclamation point. I love you, Detroit, dot, dot, dot. Wow.
It's emotional. That's like a 30 for 30, maybe. What if I told you a guy was traded?
Did Andre not have the internet? Oh, I have some more bad news. League source says there will be no buyout for Tristan Thompson in Cleveland. So I just said 20 minutes ago, I guaranteed a buyout.
Edit that
Kyle,
out.
Edit that out.
Edit that
never
out,
happened.
Kyle.
Oh, shit, we're taping this. Fuck. Why wouldn't they buy him out? I don't understand. Is that posturing?
I don't understand.
Why wouldn't you save like $2.5 million? All he's going to do is help you have a better record so you have a worse draft pick. Why wouldn't you get rid of him?
I don't know. Are they going to Twin Towers? Are they going to zag? The ultimate zag? Thompson and Drummond?
That would be funny if...
Elbows? Double elbow? Like,
Kobe Altman's got his guys in his war room. And he's like, guys, I have an idea.
Let's go.
Everyone's trying to get shooting. Yeah. What about rebounds?
Yeah.
If we win the rebounding battle every night, get 30 rebounds a night between Drummond and Love. What does that look like?
What if our new thing is boxing out?
They miss a shot, the other team.
We miss
one chance.
We miss a ton of shots.
We're going to have a lot of offensive rebounds.
Right.
Two guys pounding the boards. Going back old school. Bring back the 80s. All right, we have to talk about this Houston 4-team trade that happened. I don't know what to make of Atlanta. What was weird to me is Bates Diop was one of those guys when you watch League Pass and you go, wait, which one's Culver and which one's Bates Diop? Which one's the guy they drafted?
I feel like Timberwolves,
with the sixth pick?
The Timberwolves like uniforms at times, I'd be like, oh man, Culver's moving pretty good. Oh, that's Wiggins. Like,
right,
I would
get
so confused.
Yeah,
because
they have
time.
The high camera angle.
I don't know what the hell was
all
going on.
All the wing guys on both teams, but Bates Diop I liked, and Denver just kind of sneaks him into the trade, and he's just a throw in, and people, you know, he's the guy with the hyphen, but I actually feel like he could play in a playoff series for them. I can't believe I'm saying that.
Yeah, I don't know. I
just liked him. He's a
like
classic,
the
3
Denver
and D guy.
Hall in that deal, you're like, wait, what?
They got a Rockets first.
That's fine, but I'm
some
just saying
crap,
for like a team that...
And Bates Diop for basically they gave up Malik Beasley, who they weren't going to sign anyway because he's a restricted free agent and he's going to leave.
Yeah, they couldn't work that thing out. And I actually think Beasley became a little overrated and all this. So that 4-team trade was really weird because you're just going, what is this again?
It seemed like the four GMs were at a hotel bar at 3:30 in the morning and had too much.
Like, do you just want to trade something?
Yeah, what do you got? Can I get Bates Diop? Sure!
Yeah. Text her.
Here he is.
No, text her. That'd be cool.
Text her.
You got that like 10 seconds later. Thanks, though.
Guys who didn't get traded. So I have a list. I'm sorry, guys. I've done a terrible job of throwing to the graphics. The ball.
We
I had,
had
a list.
Graphics this whole
yeah, we
show?
We had some graphics.
Oh, no.
Yeah, my bad. I got excited. I had a list of the ballsy trade assets.
Yeah, yeah.
Porzingis. D'Angelo Russell, Jrue Holiday, Victor Oladipo I had on that list, Aaron Gordon and Miles Turner. Those were like the six guys where, oh man, they fucking threw their balls on the table with that one. Russell did get traded. Out of those other guys, I guess Holiday was throwing a lot of stuff. If I'm New Orleans, the way Zion's playing, we should talk about Zion. I'm not trading Jrue Holiday. If Jrue Holiday, Brandon Ingram, and Zion Williamson, and all this other stuff. I'm not trading away people. If anything, I'm going to try to acquire people. I was surprised he was in trade stuff that much. The guy that I thought was going to go was Bogdanović on Sacramento, and I thought that was going to be Denver's trade target. I was
that
telling
Windhorst
awesome. And Zach, I was like, why is everybody talking about Jrue Holiday with Denver? It's going to be Bogdanović. But then once Sacramento made that Dwayne Dedman deal, it was clear that they were clearing space for Bogdanović for this summer, so that wasn't going to happen. But did you think there was any chance Holiday was going to get traded? Because I did not.
The price tag I heard on it was massive.
Well, the smart teams like love his stats and stuff.
And that I think in this game, you know what as much as I look at some of these offensive players, and I this happens with Toronto a lot, where
If you're not warding people off with your off arm as an offensive player, if you're not chucking people to the ground with your off hand, then you're doing it wrong.
Yeah.
Like what you're allowed to do now with your off arm is ridiculous. So you can talk about not hand checking defensively. You're basically allowed to hand chuck. And Siakam has it where he wards you off. I mean, Giannis has been carrying the ball and doing this stuff for a while.
Kawhi,
a lot of that shoulder, but it like doesn't look like he's doing it. Lowry dribbles straight into you as a running back.
Right.
But what I do like about Lowry when he's not complaining the entire game is that he does a great job with Van Vliet of kind of like, you run it, I'll run it, where that can be problematic for a lot of teams.
Chris Paul's another one that's good at it now.
They're so good at it in Toronto, and that's what I think you get when you get a Jrue Holiday. Because he's had to do it with Lonzo. We know he's good defensively.
That's
why
we're good together.
Yeah.
I just took a piss, and I came back. You were talking about the Wu-Tang Clan. It was great. I wasn't worried at all.
What if I had just come back and be like, hey, we were done with the deadline. We're doing 90s re-listenables.
You're just like, or you were just sitting here like this.
Like, I got nervous. I froze. Yeah. I did that once on an ESPN news bump. We used to have these two-minute bumps.
Yeah.
And they were always brutal. And you were like, hey, what do you want to do for TV? And we'd look at each other and be like, what are we? I don't know. And it was never as good as you want it to be. I go, hey, I'm in a freeze. Like, Scott was gone. He forgot to come back.
Yeah.
He forgot to come back for it. So I just went to Stanford Steve. I'm like, hey, I'm going to freeze. I'm going to pretend I'm so nervous because I'm in here by myself. Who cares? Let's just do it. And I was like, oh, he's
trying to get on the internet.
Yeah, producers are like, go, go. Like, what's he doing? They didn't see the humor in it.
When I did Countdown, we had those 20-second breaks during the game where they come out of commercial and it's like, in Philadelphia, Ben Simmons had 32 points tonight and it's got to be 20 seconds exactly and it ends with, let's go back to Hubie and Mark Jones in San Antonio.
And you would do it? You would voice it?
So it was the year it was me, Wilbon, Jalen, and Magic. Magic was going to do it.
Right.
Wilbon was, you know, at his desk. So it was me or Jalen. So Jalen would do a lot of it. But then I was like, I really want to start doing these. I want to help out. And I would do them. And I can't tell you how incompetent I was.
It's actually harder to do those,
it's
but the funny so thing is
so hard to do. But you have to do it in the 20 seconds.
Yeah.
And I would be like either too soon,
when you
too
get
late,
caught too, it's the worst.
I'd forget. Yeah. I'd get into it. I'd forget who I was throwing the game to, and I'd be like, back to you guys. It's really hard.
Because a couple analysts are good at it.
Yeah.
Then what happens, like the industry will go, hey, you know what's really cool is the analyst is tossing a break now. So let's do that. And
I couldn't read highlights. I just was bad at it. But
it's harder to do than you think. I
could host
I
by the end of the first season, I could host the show. I could bring you in. I could introduce people. I could set up. I could drive it. And then it was the highlights were like my kryptonite. Let's go to Miami.
So we used to do call sheets where we would call it my Sports Center tryout for these stupid TV segments that we did.
Yeah.
And Van Pelt's like an anchor man.
Right.
Right.
Those guys, so like, it's like a special
right. So
DNA.
They take it kind of seriously. Like my whole point was I was going to screw with that and be like, all right, we're Nats Cubbies, you know. Matt Joyce, test him for roids. That one is gone. I just started like doing all these stupid things.
Peter Cup!
Right, yeah, man. Like, oh, wow, he's not going home alone tonight. Boom. Anyway.
Can we go ballsy trade assets cheaper?
Yes.
Here's that list. Marcus Smart didn't go anywhere.
Can I ask you that? If there was a nice player that they liked, a big that made sense, would you be in the camp of you can't trade Marcus Smart at all because of what he means spiritually to the Celtics?
I would have traded him for Miles Turner if that was on the table.
All right. So
I would have done if it was Miles Turner and Aaron Holiday together for Smart, whatever, one of the picks, whatever
Langford,
that version is.
Is Langford untouchable?
Did you see him last night?
I didn't watch a ton of last night's game.
I do like Langford. I mean, I don't feel like a lot of people are untouchable on the Celtics except for Tatum and Brown and Kemba. I would say there's three untouchable people.
I honestly would keep Tatum and Brown above everything.
Yeah, I think
that's what this league is.
Yeah.
Multiple position wings, man.
The thing with Smart, and KOC and I have done a lot of texting about it, and I really like Marcus Smart, and I think he's an awesome Celtic, and he's a guy that when he retires, there will be a night for him, and if he plays his whole career, he'll have his number retired.
A number retired?
Well, if he's there for 17 years or something, I could see like some
maybe a
complete
pan,
overreaction.
Maybe a pamphlet.
At least a long video.
Yes, longer than the Dwight Howard Houston Rockets return tribute video.
The problem is when everybody's back, he kind of has to be out there because he's Marcus Smart and he's got this kind of hold over everybody. But now you're playing with Kemba. that means I can only play two of Brown and Tatum and Hayward, and I need a big, or I could go small. I just don't think he's one of their best five players. Or I guess I should say one of their best four players if you assume that you need a big. I always want them to play the three wings together in the last 7 minutes of a game. I know all the stuff Marcus does, but I think the advantage that this Celtics team has is the interchangeability of those three guys at the wing.
Yeah.
And the fact that all of them can create their shot, all of them can play slash and kick, and you put Marcus in there, and he's just not as good of an offensive player as those guys. He's not. He can have streaks. He can make 11 threes in a game.
He took, what, 22 threes in that Phoenix game?
Yeah, and
a bunch
guess
of guys
what?
Are
they lost. And yeah. it's one of those
he
things
He made
where,
a bunch, too.
Yeah.
But
when he's doing better and his usage rate is up, I actually think that's in a bad place for the Celtics.
Totally
My dream game for him is 2-for-4 with, like, 8 assists, 9 rebounds, and 3 steals. That's what I want from him. But he's one of those guys. He's kind of overqualified to be that guy. And I don't know. I just think for the destiny of that team, it's those three wings on the court at the same time with Kemba and a big, and that's when they're the hardest to play.
I hit the wrong tab on Marcus Smart here. Do you want to guess what his total fines paid for suspensions and technicals and everything is?
Oh, that's amazing. Yeah, I'd love to guess this. $132,000?
$280,000.
Oh, my God.
I had...
What did he do?
Well, he got $50,000 for the Embiid thing last year.
Oh.
He got... the Bembry fight was $35,000.
Fight's strong. Fight's a strong one.
Right, right. But obscene gesture during the Chicago playoff game. I couldn't believe it. I hit the wrong tab. I'm like, oh, my gosh. Like, every technical's $2,000.
So out of those Bozzi trade assets.
Oh, it's $2,000.
If I were the Nets, I would have traded Dinwiddie because I think ultimately if you're going to keep Kyrie and KD together, I don't know where Dinwiddie plays. He's not a complimentary guy. I think he wants to be a real guy. And I thought it was interesting they didn't trade him. I had Van Vliet on this list just because he's got a year left and it's the kind of weird ballsy Masai move. We're like, wow, they traded Van Vliet. He won them the title, but they end up winning the trade.
By the way, it's a player option, but to have – Yeah, I don't know. The Dinwiddie thing. I just wanted to double check that contract because it's a nice number.
It's got a couple years.
It was a good extension, but it isn't. He has only the player option going into I honestly think Dinwiddie at his production at 11.5 for another year, you're not in a hurry to
Yeah, you're waiting to see. So. That's a good point. Joe Harris is a free agent. I was wondering if they just packed it in this year. Could somebody get him?
Do the Van Vliet thing again, because I'm gonna ask you, would you rather keep Lowry or Van Vliet?
Well, I have to pay Van Vliet.
Yeah.
I'm eventually going to have to pay him. If I were Toronto, I wouldn't do anything. I think they still have a chance to win the East. I don't think this 12-game winning streak's a fluke. It's what goes what we talked about with teams that just look crisp and know who they are. That team knows who they are.
People love Nick Nurse too, man.
And they managed, we talked about this the last time we did a pod, they managed to replace the Kawhi stats and then the Siakam stats from last year. With Siakam basically replacing the Kawhi stats, and he plays more. And then all those other guys replacing what Siakam gave them. The math just has worked with what they did, which I think is – I wasn't prepared for that. You would have thought, oh, they'll definitely be worse without Kawhi, and they're just – for regular season, they're not.
Playoffs,
would be worse.
Let's see.
But regular season, they have not been worse.
Because when you look back at Siakam's game logs to the playoffs, you're like, oh, that was better than I remembered it. But watching it, I felt like – Where is he?
Game 7 Philly, which we did a rewatchables on.
That whole game was ugly, though. So.
And I thought Harrell was the other one that if I was the Clippers, and I'm just now staring at 3 7-game series in a row in the West, followed by the finals, can I win the title of Harrell as my crunch time 5? Or is he somebody that should be a matchup guy?
I thought it was something that they were very – like, that's a front office I respect a lot, and that they may have thought – Hey, is there a way to flip this that we feel like we're different but at the same level, but we like where we are next year instead of worrying about the Montrez thing? But that's a harder like hole to thread, man. It just is. Like that's a clear example of, okay, fine, you want to do that, then what are we talking about? Real quick in Toronto, though, they're second in defense right now, too, behind Milwaukee's like so far ahead of everybody else. But that Toronto is number 2.
The point you made about how they fight when they're down too.
Yeah.
And there's just certain teams that are – I think that Stevens, whoever he's had on the Celtics, year after year, they're down 7 with 42 seconds left, and he's diagramming plays out of timeouts and doing little mini presses and things like that. Certain teams are just going to keep fighting until the game's over. I didn't expect Toronto to be one of those teams. This, you know, they won the title last year. You would have totally understood if it was like, all right, we won the title, cool.
Yeah, you know, to get back
it's
to
the
it,
opposite.
You know who doesn't look like that? It's Philly.
Well, you know who else doesn't look like that? It's the Clippers. And the Clippers would be like, well, Kawhi didn't play tonight. Well, this guy didn't play.
Yeah,
like,
that's why I kind
of the lack
still...
of urgency with them is really weird. I think it's a real flaw. I know you and I are doing NBA podcasts every week the rest of the way, and I know we're going to dissect the Clippers endlessly. They're acting like a team that won the title, and they've never won jack shit. They're having like the championship hangover season. It's like it's a hangover of the fact that you just signed these two guys and gave away 700 draft picks. Go fucking win something. I don't like what I see from them.
But
I went to the
Kings
game
time.
Last week. And
yeah.
I just
it did was you like, watch well, the Heat game last night though?
I didn't see that one.
That was like one of those things. They're down. You're like, oh, Miami's so tight. And again, Jimmy ended up leaving the game.
Yeah.
But they came out and like everybody hit shots in the third quarter, and they're just like, see ya. You know. Like we're good here, but for Miami to lose Jimmy is different for other
I don't
teams
like
than their best guy.
I don't like having an on-off button when I've never done anything as a team. Now Kawhi deserves to have an on-off button, but the other guys don't. Paul George, I can promise you.
But that's what's kind of interesting now about what this league is that we usually had one or two teams that you by default believe in a little bit because of something they've done before, and it's why you know. Look, I've gone off on the Milwaukee thing, but like, hey, guess what, Milwaukee? Like, you lost four in a row after being up 2-0 when everybody thought Kawhi was hurt. You haven't done anything. It's scary to see how good you are right now, even without Brogdon. Like, the stuff that they're doing, and like, Giannis is in a weird way, like this taller Harden who obviously
yeah.
can't shoot like Harden, but it's all set up around him. But I just like it a little bit more because it doesn't seem like so ISO heavy, and Giannis just doesn't seem as disengaged at times when he's not involved. And yet they haven't done anything. Denver has never done anything with this group. This Lakers group has never done anything. The Clippers group has never done anything. Philly can't get out of the second round. This Boston group hasn't done anything.
Yeah.
Like the Pacers thing, that's a nice story. Toronto without Kawhi, we don't know what it is. And, you know, it is very – it's very similar. Like when Memphis was up 2-0 on Golden State, because that Golden State team had only beaten a Denver team that had a bunch of wins and then
right.
lost to San Antonio, it was – like, this isn't specific to Denver or Milwaukee or Toronto last year or anything. It's just how we operate.
It's nut crutch time.
Until you've done something that we can bank on, we have a hard time believing in you. It's just so hard to go,
it's
hey.
Sixers Celtics 2 years ago.
Exactly. Like, hey, you've never done it, but I'm all in that you're going to win a title or even just come out of your conference. And beyond, you know, Golden State with the – it's even more so now. Like, the East was new last year, but it was a Kawhi – you still had Golden State before all those injuries. Now it's just a free-for-all of teams that were going, I don't know what you're going to be like. And that's why I think the Lakers throughout all of this, and the Kuzma thing never really made any sense for all the pieces that you'd have to do because of his contract. That's why I think there's still a default part of believing in this version of LeBron going, you know, I know you've lost to the Clippers a couple times, but in the playoffs, like, I could see everybody picking them.
There's a physicality that they're going to have in the playoffs that I think is the X factor. And if I'm the Clippers, I'm the most scared of that. Two guys physically, what they're going to be able to do when everything slows down, when the refs are going to be deciding every game by how much contact they're going to allow versus what they're not going to allow.
And just what like Davis and James can do in a game. But if I'm on the Clippers, the counter would be like, hey, do you want me to show you the Kawhi tape from last year?
Right.
So
I called up the Milwaukee stats because I wanted to mention this to you.
Their point differential is the best in history so far, right?
Well, they're 43-7. And if they win, I don't know, 7 more games and they're 50-7. And you start thinking about the 73-9 and all the shitty teams are going to be playing in the East down the stretch. There's only 6 good teams in the East. Everybody else will be doing
right.
whatever. And it's like, what if this team only loses 2 more times? Or what if this team's in the conversation for 70 wins? And you look at their stats and the advanced team stuff and all the defense,
well, yeah.
all the three-point shooting. But, like,
they'd have to
George Hill's shooting 51% from three. And you said, like, I can't believe they're doing this with Brogdon gone. And I felt the same way the
yeah,
whole year.
Yeah, wait a minute. By the way, though, like, I just did it. So they'd have to go 30-2 to tie it.
Yeah, but teams have gone on 29-2 streaks, though. It's conceivable. But they were able to replace.
Everybody's so obsessed with rest. They won't.
They were able
guys.
To replace the Brogdon thing with this weird George Hill Wesley Matthews.
Better Bledsoe.
And better Bledsoe. But, like, I thought Wesley Matthews was done as a reasonable rotation
DiVincenzo,
guy.
I think, is worth
yeah.
mentioning.
But the Wesley Matthews thing seemed like he was headed toward the end of his career. And then George Hill was available for anybody last trade deadline. Anybody could have had him, and they were like, ah, George Hill, he's not good anymore. And meanwhile, he was...
Remember Hill couldn't get on the floor, I think, during that Cavs series a couple years ago? Wasn't that like...
Well, he also missed the big free throw in the JR timeout game.
Yeah, but Van Gundy was like, whoa, like he's not even playing? I'd have to go back and look at some of that, but I remember that being something.
He's playing... George Hill's playing 21 minutes a game, right? Brogdon was probably around 28, 29. The 21 minutes he's playing are as good as the 28 minutes Brogdon was giving them. They have to make up the other seven. But, yeah, I'm with you that the rest thing might mean that maybe it doesn't happen. But at the same time, like, these guys are just killing people. And at some point, you got to think, like, is 30-2 even realistic? All right, some last thoughts. We had the blow-it-up trade pieces list. If the team was like, fuck it. I had Chris Paul, Gordon Hayward, Al Horford, LaMarcus Aldridge, Steven Adams, and Gallinari. Three of those guys are in OKC. If OKC was just like, fuck it. I actually like that they didn't do that. I wish they'd gone the other way and traded for a wing guy.
Yeah, because they have this collection of like wings where you go.
Well, they have
who is that again?
They have this weird wrinkle with them, though, where if the pick is 1 through 20 protected, otherwise somebody gets it. Can't remember who. It's one of the trades they made. So it's in their interest.
Is that the Miami one that they wanted unprotected? Right. Yeah.
So
they wanted to change the language on that.
No, that was the pick. I think Miami's sending them down the road.
I don't know.
Oklahoma City's pick is going somewhere. Maybe Philly? Philly or Denver, one of those two teams. Jackson, find this out. Find out where Oklahoma City's pick is going to. But it's 1 through 20 protected. So if they play themselves into the top 10 – then they lose their first rounder. I don't know if that's a factor for them, but the one that
you know what it shouldn't be because of
they're good
and the stockpiling of first rounders.
Yeah,
they have,
how many picks do you need? The one that surprises me going through that list, Horford. I'm not sure there's a
yeah, but we're talking protection, not lose it outright. We're talking about it then just being kicked down.
If it's 1 through 20, they keep it.
Right,
but if they're 21, they lose it.
Lose
OKC's
it that year.
Pick. Right. This year, this one in June.
Okay, that was a good segment.
Well, we are at like hour 37. The one that surprises me is if I thought San Antonio was going to secretly trade Aldridge. That was one of my every year there's one random guy nobody knows he's available, and then all of a sudden he's on another team. He makes $26 million this year,
but they gave him guarantee for next year.
And he's got his contract next year.
Yeah,
but I'm just saying,
25, 24 million next year. 35 years old.
If you're the Spurs, why are you running this back? You're going to run it back next year. You're going to pay $57 million, $55 million, whatever, for DeRozan and Aldridge as your two best guys. You're not a playoff team. Where was the incentive for them to just say,
do you think
we're good, let's roll it over?
A part of Pop that he wants nothing to do with, like, hey, we really need to tear this down. We really need to see what we have in DeJounte. Do you think Derek White would be considered a better player if he changed up his look?
What do you mean?
Like, whenever I see his hair, beard, combo, sides, I'm like, if he just tightened that up, I think guys would be like, hey, you know what? I want to get a Derek White t-shirt. But, yeah, I mean, he single-handedly was, like, insane in some of those Nuggets games.
Right.
And then you go, okay, now he has 2 points again.
They're 22 and 28.
Yeah, they're not good. And we knew last year, like, that team making the playoffs last year, and it was one of the biggest slides. Like, this isn't even a knock on San Antonio. You go, okay, eventually, like, year 20, this had to happen. But defensively, they slipped in a way they hadn't slipped before. They still make the playoffs. They still scare Denver a little bit, which, you know, scared me off of Denver.
But here's my question. They're 22 and 28. New Orleans has 20 wins. Phoenix has 20 wins. Sacramento has 19 wins. Minnesota just traded for Russell. They're 7 games behind them, but who knows? There's 32
games.
What
is New Orleans, 6 games out?
New Orleans is two and a half games behind San Antonio.
No, but I'm talking out of the 8th, out of Memphis.
Yeah, New Orleans is – Memphis is 26 and 25. So everybody is within striking range of Memphis, potentially. If I'm San Antonio, I would have actually maybe tried to make the move. Hope you fall backwards. Now you're in, like, the top 8. Now I don't have to worry about Aldridge and DeRozan next year. I don't know. I thought it was weird that they just were like, we're good. We're just going to be depressing as always. We're going to take some.
I honestly, this was long overdue, though. This was so overdue for this franchise to actually have the moment of malaise and trying to figure
they're
out.
They're in no man's land.
But, you know, and DeRozan is not, he's a player option. this summer at 27.8. He probably picks it up.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Yeah.
He's never seen that again.
And honestly, like anybody that goes, hey, you need to trade DeRozan. And this is the selfishness, the lens that you watch.
Where's
trades.
He going?
When you're trading for DeRozan, all you're trading for is a bill. And a guy that's proven, despite the offensive stuff that you can see at times and the consistent, like, hey, look at these numbers, look at these numbers. It never works. It doesn't ever seem to add up. And people will tell you historically over the years, the plus minus with DeRozan, you go, oh, wait, so, like, you're worse every time he's out there?
I wonder with the Grizzlies. They're 8 seed right now. They basically have a 2.5 lead over – 2.5 game lead over everybody, including Portland. Portland Dame is, like, flames are shooting out of his ass.
This is
they have to be taken
this,
seriously. One of the great runs of all time. For a guard, he averaged 8 straight games, 45 a game as from the guard position, which is like you're now in a different stratosphere.
And that was kind of that Golden State game when you were talking about D'Angelo Russell and the basketball we don't really like, where it's like, hey, D'Angelo, we're going to set 4 versions of a high screen, dribble to one side, and then you jack up a 30-footer. And that's when Dame was like, okay, but I'm also going to do it and make every single one of them.
Right, and just completely cut the heart out of the other team. But Memphis traded Crowder today, and they got – they got Winslow back in the deal, but he's, as you said, he's played 11 games. And Crowder, if you watch Memphis, was weirdly important to him. Like, he was playing crunch time, and he was doing stuff.
I think you always need one guy that at least pretends he's going to fight, real or not.
Yeah.
I think every team needs a Matt Barnes type.
I thought he was important for them, for what the team that they had become. That was a really fun league pass team to watch. And they, now they lost him. They didn't really replace him unless Winslow comes back. My point is, I think New Orleans or Portland is probably going to catch Memphis. I don't see this Memphis thing continuing to go. Just in general,
six
I think
games a lot,
the fact that they were like 14-5 over the last 19, they're not that good.
I'd bet you if I went through too, because like when Utah was turning this thing around and it was like, oh, okay, cool, finally, like you're winning games, and you went through it and you're like, the only time you had a good win through this whole thing was, I think there was a Clippers win in there, but it may have been without one of the two. It might have been a non-Paul George. It probably was a non-Paul George win.
I want to talk about Fat Zion at a later date, and I call him that affectionately because I think there's some serious Barkley shit going on. It really reminds me a lot of mid-'80s Barkley, where it doesn't really matter what
my
he looks
favorite
like.
Player of all time.
Oh, my God. He's athletically, all that stuff. And, you know, last week was all about Kobe, and rightly so, but Zion's out there putting up 20-10 in these games he hadn't played all season and is a complete mismatch.
Against everybody, this, you know, anybody that was like, "Oh, well, when he gets against men," you're like, "No, you don't understand what this guy is."
He's the biggest man. Yeah. There's some LeBron, late 2000s kind of shit where it's just like, "Oh, he's just more of a specimen than anybody who's guarding him." And the thing I've learned just through six games is you can play him at the five. You can.
Well, that was what he always should have been. Like, you know, Mike Schmitz, I'm going to give credit for the ESPN draft guy, and like, you know, I'm going through, and I would text, I'd be like, I think you're right on with this five thing. And
Mike Schmitz, point five,
right? And he went out on GetUp, and he sat down, and it was like three ex-NBA players and like Greeny, and like here's, you know, Mike Schmitz with his notebook out, and he's like, yeah, he should be a center, and all the NBA guys that are analysts laughed in his face, get off the set. It was like when I said Doncic reminds me of Harden on a TV show, and the next player was like, oh my God, this idiot,
right?
And you just go like, first of all, I know I put way more work into it than you have,
yeah,
but whatever, like you played, I didn't.
You're like, sorry, Damon Jones,
but he was like, anybody that watched Zion was like, if this league is smaller, then why wouldn't you guys – why, like, who cares about Jackson Hayes? Shout out, by the way.
Right.
Not a knock on any of those other guys. Like, the best version of Zion, at least right now, is the five, because he's going to work the hell out of anybody else. Like, it doesn't matter that he's shorter.
When he posts up, whether they put him at, like, the foul line or the lower block, the extra size that he has just from being an adult, maybe there's some baby fat on there, whatever. It's like, if he does this and plants himself, he's getting the ball.
Yeah.
You're not going to be reaching around
and
him.
And his feet in the second jump leaves everybody in like, what? He's already up.
The second jump looks like some Matrix shit.
Right. Now, then
where
when
it's like, you just jumped. You're jumping again? I just was watching your first jump.
Okay, but then there's never been anybody I don't think I've ever seen that every time he's subbed out, I'm like, is he hurt? Just when he's like.
Yeah, true. He walks like he's like, 80 years old.
What is going on? And
he has these moves where it looks like somebody's fast-forwarding him.
LaVine had that, or like, has it still.
Oh, my God.
Right? Like, Westbrook had it, but then the times where LaVine, you're like, oh, my God.
I feel vindicated because the job was doing really well. Zion was hurt. And there was this little like, Zion.
Mark Jackson said it within 4 minutes.
Mark Jackson game.
When it was fat Zion, the first 4 minutes, when he was fat shamed.
He's the new Greg Oden.
And it was like, everybody was like, this guy's so fat. Look at he's hurt. And then Mark Jackson was like, shit, 8 minutes into the first quarter, I would have taken Ja. I was like, oh, my God, dude. I'm like, this kid isn't even, he's not even sweating yet.
You and I never wavered. I thought he was one of.
But then people made fun of us for being like, oh, you know, thanks, Captain Obvious. Like, is it? Because I feel like there's a lot of people that didn't quite get him.
I remember I went on Francesa's show and I said something like, he's one of the three biggest sure things of the past, like, 30 years. Out of all the guys drafted
good
first.
For you.
Something like that. I was just like, the guy's a sure thing. The only thing that will hurt him is if he gets injured. But by the way, watch Memphis. Watch all the crazy fucking shit Ja does. I think Ja is just as big of an injury risk. God bless it. I hope it doesn't happen.
Yeah, but Ja doesn't look like he blew an ACL
but
when
Ja's
he gets subbed
going,
out. Yeah.
Ja's going horizontal sideways, getting undercut, and somehow landing perfectly every time. But it scares me. Like
that's
it,
just all the collagen, like being young
Jesus.
And landing. Like
he's
Gordon
so
Hayward,
fearless.
Gordon Hayward, I thought, blew out his knee helping somebody up the other night. Right? And I was like, oh, no, this again?
Zion is absolutely jaw-droppingly incredible to watch. And
I plan my week around him.
One of the few guys that when you're watching him, you just kind of go, I don't know what they're going to do when he really figures this out. Like, what's
the move?
It
was great, too.
Because if you double him, he makes the perfect pass.
Well, that's the best part of his game, I think. It isn't the best because the physical part of what he can do when he's near the
ball.
That's
the thing. Zach's been blown away by the passing because Zach doesn't watch college.
Oh, he didn't watch it?
Yeah.
No,
it
was
like
– when you watch him get going at Duke
spacing,
in transition, it was awesome.
Yeah, he's a fucking awesome
and then,
passer.
Even though, like, his three-point numbers weren't great, but oddly they were better than, like, R.J. Barrett's, better than Reddish at Duke. He was a better three-point shooter than his teammates who couldn't make any shots at the end of the year. But for him to hit those four – and the fourth one, you never make it when you're like, should I shoot? Oh, I'm not going to shoot. Ah, hell, I'll shoot. And then it goes
and then
in.
It's like, oh.
And I'm just at home laughing because it was such a great 180 because you knew what was going to happen. It was going to be a bunch of dudes who do what we do in line to be the first guy that next morning after that Spurs game to be like, I don't see it.
Yeah.
And you just go, well.
He's too fat. Too much weight.
Does he want
it? He's going to break down.
Does he
and
want
it's like, first of all, his body is unlike anybody else's body ever. And I don't know what it's supposed to look like. I've never seen a body like this except for Barkley. Barkley was 4 inches shorter than he is.
Yeah, I think Barkley was actually Barkley didn't walk around like he was hurt all the time. So I'm worried about it. Like when I think of Oden, I get into these arguments all the time with my friends. They're like, Oden's a bust. No. Like busts, like Dragon Bender's a bust.
Okay? Hashim Thabeet is a bust.
Hashim Thabeet's a bust. Greg Oden was going to be awesome.
Yeah,
he was when it started clicking and coming along.
That game's on YouTube, the national title game, and he's playing with like a broken wrist, and he's still fucking dominating Horford and Noah.
And he's showing. He's coming all the way to the 3-point
awesome
line to meet guys.
It's a bummer.
And he had a Portland run where you're like, okay, this is going to be awesome. And then he was hurt, and then he didn't trust anybody, and then he was more hurt than we thought. I don't want to hear like if Zion's hurt. I just don't think a bust is if you're hurt. That's my rule.
Okay.
No one agrees.
We're going to leave, but I want to do Mookie Betts for 2 minutes.
Sure.
The Red Sox, who make $500+ million a year in revenue, who have a $200 million
documented,
and they still are, whatever their salary is, they're making money every year. I just got to burn their saddle to trade Mookie Betts. I'm sure they're going to leak, like, we never could have kept him. He was going to leave. He wanted $400 million, all that. And it's like, well, he should get $400 million because that's what it costs to have one of the best outfielders the last 20 years. He's the best position player they've had since Ted Williams. He really helped them win the 2018 World Series in ways beyond just him being awesome. It's Mike Scherer, we were texting about it, and he was saying the throw that he made to throw out Tony Kemp in the Houston series – he said was the greatest story he's ever seen in his life. I actually agree. He had a huge homer against the Dodgers. Was just a guy like, if you're trying to win the World Series, he's the guy you're trading for, not the guy you're trading. And I'm just stupefied by the whole thing. I don't understand it. I didn't understand it as it was happening. The trade wasn't that good. I don't understand the point of saving luxury tax money for next year, so then you can go try to get a guy almost as good as Mookie Betts. And then on top of it, like, I just thought he should have been a meaningful guy in the city. You know, I think he's just a really good guy who is different than a lot of Red Sox players in a lot of ways. Who's certainly the best black baseball player they've ever had. And I think that matters for a variety of reasons. And I was just so upset. Like, it honestly makes me not – I know I'll talk myself into the season again. I know I'll start watching it because that's the habit of baseball. But this is the first thing they've done since I was, like, a kid that made me kind of not want to throw myself into the season. And I have not – I just have not wrapped my head around it. I just can't believe they did this.
So – I would always start with this. Like, if Mookie deep down didn't want to play here, I don't know the answer to that.
Jim
sure
Rice said yesterday
out.
He was like, Mookie wanted to stay in Boston,
right.
And I believe Jim Rice.
I want to believe that then. And when I went through it and I did it on my podcast, there's been 19 contracts north of $200 million in baseball history. We've just started to like hit some serious numbers. I would argue, considering A-Rod signed for $252 million in 2001, that maybe some of these bigger contracts were long overdue.
Yeah,
if you look at some of the revenue split stuff and the percentage of revenue going to the major league players, and owners argue about, oh, no, we have to pay for all the minor league stuff too, which I do understand. You know, it's not a bad split, but it's going down. I just don't understand, like, how were some of these contracts happening? How was it almost a Manny Ramirez $200 million contract happening, A-Rod 252?
That was 20 years ago.
How was that happening 20 years ago, and now we've only had 17 other ones since then? Like, but that's weird.
How is it not happening with the team that paid Evaldi – basically like a tip at the end of the night at a wedding, they gave him a $60 million contract. And then 9 months later, like, oh, man, the tax.
Yeah, it's 4 years, like, $68 million. But no one complained about it because of what he did in the 18
inning
loss.
Well, because we just
game.
Assumed they were going to spend money every year because right. They're the fucking Red Sox, and they're a cash cow.
The Evaldi deal wasn't great. The Sale deal seemed to be premature, but the Price deal is the one that absolutely drives me crazy. They offered Price $51 million more than the next best offer.
Right. They're a drunk guy in the fantasy league.
For a guy that didn't want to play there ever. He never wanted to play in Boston. He was miserable the whole time. He gets kind of that J.D. Jrue pass because of what happened with the World Series. But for the most part, right, but they didn't. Like, Price, the whole thing was a bad deal. He was the third highest paid player in baseball the year he was signed.
World Series champ.
Whatever.
2018 World
deal,
champ.
Those deals, like, whenever fans go, who cares? It's not my money. No. That deal, you paid Zach Greinke money. You paid Clayton Kershaw money for David Price.
Yeah,
for a guy that didn't even like being in the city. And that set these things in motion. So now all of a sudden you're going to be cheap with Mookie Betts. And then the other part of
it's the all-time poor planning of seven different things leading to an equally terrible decision.
I've seen all of these things where it's like, okay, well, he owed it to the union. Who cares? Okay, he's going to get paid. Oh, this allows the Red Sox all this financial flexibility. What? To go get somebody who's not as good as him?
Right.
That's a terrible,
is there
terrible
poor
argument.
Man's Mookie Betts out there that and we could spend $200 million
if on? You're looking at Verdugo, who is a one-season guy, who might not be bad because the splits are pretty good.
With the bad back.
But missed the last 2 months, neck and back pain.
Yeah.
And then
attitude problems in the minors.
Gratterall, who's blown out his elbow, missed all of 16.
It seems like a medical
half
risk.
Half 17. And I love that Boston Globe was like, facts about him, signs autographs until everybody is done. You're like, okay, what about the part where he may weigh 270 pounds and he's 21 years old?
Facts about him, his elbow ligament is made out of his hamstring.
The whole, like, oh, well, you couldn't go into the season with Mookie. Who gives a shit? These are pro athletes, and I know it's not great to be in the trade rumors, but, like, every single NBA player thinks he's getting traded the whole time.
Well,
the only person who can't handle a trade rumor is Jamal Adams. So, you know, if Mookie Betts, like, has to go in and, like, it's unsettled, then let it be unsettled. If the best that you're doing is that we don't know if Verdugo's an everyday outfielder and a guy that's had this injury history who's out of shape, if that's the best you could do, you could definitely do that before the trade deadline this upcoming year.
So that was
year.
My
that's
argument.
The thing that doesn't make – anybody that says you had to do this now because it was the best deal you're going to get, if this is the best deal and you're Bloom and everybody thinks maybe Friedman worked you because you used to work for him in Tampa, which may be completely unfair, if I'm Bloom, I go, hey, you know what? Most of us get fired in this job anyway. I'm not doing that. How do the Dodgers not give up a prospect in this deal and only Kent Maeda – when you get Mookie Betts likely in a spot where you know you're going to re-sign him. That's where you have to be vigilant and going, I'm not doing this. I don't care. I'm not doing this unless we're getting one of the Dodgers top
fives. Go back to your point,
fives.
Though. Pau Gasol, 2008. One of the reasons, 2008, February. One of the reasons everyone was so upset about that deal, other than nobody knew who's on the block, was they did it two weeks before the trade deadline. And Wallace was like, well, I really like the deal. I want to take it. That deal's still sitting there 2 weeks later. Guess what? The Lakers aren't going to go, you know, on second thought, Kwame Brown, Javaris Crittenden, the 30th pick, and Pau Gasol's fat brother. It's too rich for our blood now to get Pau Gasol. We've actually
cooled
off on this.
People don't realize, like, the Marcus, so there wasn't one guy that I talked to because teams,
420
were, teams were so mad because they were like, this is a Memphis Jerry West thing.
It was.
It was a total hookup.
It was a fucking 100% right. Memphis Jerry West thing. So the thing with the Mookie thing, because I've argued with Red Sox fans about this, they're like, well, if you start the season with him, you can't trade him. And I'm like,
that doesn't
okay, make- guess what? Guess who we could trade him for? Alex Verdugo and this fucking guy in the Twins whose hamstring is his elbow ligament and who's a medical risk already. I'm positive that trade was still sitting there in July.
Dude, no gyro ball?
It's so frustrating.
It's really frustrating.
It's like, why now?
And
why now?
I know that people outside of Boston be like, okay, so let me get this straight. You losers.
Right, you won four World Series.
You went 80-plus years without this. You would have sold relatives to get one. This ownership group comes in and gets four in less than 20 years. And now you're so mad that you think that, like, you don't like this ownership group.
Yeah, but here's the
thing. That's the part from the outside where I think all of those get, but, like, they don't get it. Like, this
that's
ownership,
a terrible way to look at sports.
This ownership group is buying up every piece of property around that park to the point where I think, like, the city had to be like, you guys need to chill a little on this
stuff.
Yeah,
they've killed every sort of traditional thing that's been around there to build their whole mega complex.
Sweet Caroline sucks. You know, it sucks. And, like, there's a lot of Red Sox fans who are just like, thanks for the rings, but then to do this. Like, this reminds me of the insecurity and the inferiority of being a 90s Red Sox fan. Like, this is what it was. It was like, oh, we're going to do the stupid shit. I get it. Would the Yankees ever do this? In 2020, for the Red Sox to do something that the Yankees, like, Yankees fans should be like, oh, this
reminds.
Yankees
fans were cheering this.
Like, oh, this reminds me when you guys were idiots.
Right.
Good job, despite the fact that Sox have won more rings.
Here's my counter.
Recently, not total. You're 27. We got it.
Here's my counter to the four World Series thing. Look, once they won in 04, it's house money for the rest of our lives. I just really wanted to win them once, so I never had to think about the fucking stupid curse again. I did. Winning the other ones were awesome. They were great sports experiences.
The 18 one was such a surprise, too. It really was.
I honestly care more in baseball specifically and especially about having a guy that I love for 20 years. That matters to me more than like, oh, we won in 2018. That 2018 was a year and a half ago. I can barely remember what happened in that playoff series anymore. But for six straight months, baseball is fucking boring. I still like it because I'm an old white guy. I'm the audience. I like to put it on. I like to watch Red Sox games and have them in the background as I'm doing other things. And one of the certainties I had in life was I loved Mookie Betts. I liked Devers. I like Bogarts, and I like Benintendi somewhat. 3.5 guys that I liked watching. And I was like, this is great. These guys are in my life. Every summer, until for the rest of the decade, I'm going to have these three guys. I'm going to have Devers, I'm going to have Bogarts, and I'm going to have Betts especially. Fuck. Isn't that why we follow sports?
And it's so rare, like in baseball, to go, you're going to have this guy who's basically second to Mike Trout. Who's going to go down as one of the greatest players
of all time.
Yeah,
like, Sari's not as good as Mike Trout, right, who's right. Like fucking Mickey Mantle.
Right. To go, I mean, this is just isn't, I just think the Red Sox, I don't know if the Red Sox ownership's, like, if they get it, I don't know if they go like, hey, we won the four rings. Like,
I have
get
a theory.
Over this thing.
Want to hear my theory?
Whether they're piling up assets to bounce on this thing or they're putting all their money into soccer.
I think
or,
they're going to sell. I think they didn't want to pay the luxury tax this year. I think
well, that's even
gotten,
grosser then. Give
I think
somebody
they've gotten everything they've wanted out of this franchise.
And more so.
And I
mean,
think
look,
they're going to sell. I do.
I don't know that it would make sense. But you know what you should do then? Do whatever. Like, who cares? Then Mookie be on somebody else's tab. Can't cover the luxury tax?
That's
I mean,
what Paul Gaston did with Vin Baker trade. He was like, I know I'm going to sell. I need to get under the tax. I'm getting flashbacks to that.
He was always like that.
This trade is so stupid.
You can't go over the tax.
There's no other explanation for this trade. This trade is so stupid. It makes me think they're selling the team because – and the other thing, they're so tone deaf. They've lived in the city for two decades.
Yeah, I don't understand how
they're
not getting
this. They're so tone deaf to how this stuff is received because this happened a couple of times where they shank Terry Francona and then the Globe piece comes out a couple of days later murdering him. And it's like, yeah – this looks bad. You guys did this incorrectly. The way they handled Theo.
The
all this
Theo
stuff, it's
one
like they
is,
just don't get
is,
the city.
Is mind-blowing. But I always thought the Theo thing was very a very common thing that happens. They pick Theo.
It was a mentor-mentee right. thing. Yeah, there's some Lucchino shit.
When you pick Theo, you're like, look, we looked out for you. And then Theo's like, I'm good at this. I'm out of here. Francona's the best manager I've ever seen, and I mean that as like a day-to-day thing. Like, I'm not going to sit here and say I understand other managers, but until you watch a guy every day for years, it's when you're like, hey, this guy kind of sucks.
And that team was like
And Francona
the
was
weirdest,
awesome.
Quirkiest team yeah. ever, and he managed it.
I don't really like Francona, but I think he's a great manager. So that one,
I thought Cora was awesome in 18.
I didn't have as much of a problem with some of the Francona criticism. I had massive problems with the Theo criticism because a lot of it was ageism too. Like if he had been 45, right. they would have been like, "Hey, we'll give you whatever you want." Like they brought in Mike Port to like hold his hand, and you're like, "No, you've got like a guy that's going to change the way we look at GM sitting right here. He doesn't need his hand to be held." The whole Billy Beane thing that fell apart. And then afterwards, like, Theo's like, no, I'm going to bounce. Like, I'm good. I do think this ownership thing is just like, it feels so stupid to go, oh, yeah, what's wrong with these guys when they've been so successful?
But isn't that part of their attitude, though, where it's like, we brought you four World Series.
I think
you
that's exactly,
be grateful.
That's exactly what
we'll
I think.
We'll do what we want.
Are they right or are Red Sox fans right?
Well, I think the owners that we had up until then were so atrocious, and we all saw the potential in the city and the franchise for how much people love baseball. And if somebody could figure out the park and the surrounding things, put that revenue back, and we all knew it was going to be a cash cow. It was like the worst house on the best block. And it's like, man, if somebody buys that house and makes it nice, that's going to be like a $12 million house. That's what they had. They did it. I don't think they're the only owners that could have done that. There are a lot
owners.
Of good owners in sports. Yeah. Like, look at what the Warriors did with Joe Lacob. Is Joe Lacob, I know he's light years ahead of everybody, but honestly, was he that good, or was he just not the terrible, shitty owners they had before? And with the Red Sox owners, it's like, these guys are obviously really smart. They've leveraged the land and the fan base in 7 million economic ways that have been beneficial. They put a lot of it back in the team. Why draw the line at Mookie Betts, the best position player we've had in 60 years? Why would this be the guy where you're like, all right, now it's time to cut bait?
And here's the problem. Much like, I remember they did some sort of stupid poll that was like, what are Red Sox fans like? And it was like, good players, stars. So they spent way too much money on Carl Crawford, who hated it. John Lackey, who kind of has a little bit of that David Price thing. For the most part, it wasn't that great, but he was part of that 13 run. So yeah. Everybody forgets about it and doesn't care. But this team will, and I started looking at 2021 free agents, being like, who are they going to spend like $150 million on this guy and like $120 million on this pitcher? Like, who are going to be the two B-minus guys that they signed for a ton of money, thinking like, hey, everybody, pay attention to us. The difference is when the Yankees had their run, they didn't screw around with it. Like, we're not going to sign.
They didn't screw around with their core
right.
guys.
We go like, who's the best pitcher? Is it Mike Mussina? Okay, well, like, do we want him or we want Pat Rapp? Because Pat Rapp's cheaper.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, no, let's just go get Mussina. And considering who the Red Sox have become after all those years in the 90s being told that they were a mid-market team, being conned by this trust, and Dan Duquette, who, you know, was a great talent evaluator, but was kind of a, like, I ended up getting along with him. He used to come on our show all the time, but like his end was like, get this guy
right.
out of here.
It was like a serial killer.
Right, because it just didn't, he couldn't sell it the right way. It was like Hinkie being forced to talk. Was Duquette, you know?
Especially in Boston.
And so you're like, what is up with this guy? Even though he was, again, really good at evaluating baseball players. But we were just tricked to, like, think less of ourselves. You know what I'm saying? Like, don't think you could ever be that.
It was like a damaged relationship.
Yeah, and then it happens.
But you made the key point with the Yankees. Why did the Yankees have that run? They kept Bernie Williams and Jeter and Rivera.
Remember when the Sox made an offer to Bernie Williams and then he went back to the
yeah,
Yanks?
Guess
and
what? He went
like,
back.
Yeah, and then he was like, I was really impressed by your presentation. And people were like, oh.
Thanks
like,
anyway.
What do you think? Do you think Bernie Williams is really going to leave the Yankees and sign with the Red Sox?
But I just feel like Betts, Devers, Bogarts, I don't care who else is on the team the next 10 years. I get to root for those three guys. That's the foundation you spend around. You make smart decisions. You're always going to be good. But ultimately, Mookie's going to go to the Dodgers this year, and he's going to be incredible. And people are going to watch him at Dodger Stadium with that huge field and him and Bellinger basically patrolling this fucking complex that they have out there. It's so spacious and so wide, and those guys are going to be chasing down everything. He's been in every big spot. He can handle not just Boston but playoff baseball, and he's a fucking legitimate superstar at the age of 27. Ben Lindbergh wrote for us. Said this trade had no precedent in the history of baseball. Nobody's ever traded this specific player at this age. and it's a bummer, and it really makes me wonder if I'm going to care about this Red Sox season. I know I'll rally. I know I'll go around, but it just really hurts. I was surprised like that I'm 50 and I still care about sports like this.
And I'd heard
but I'm
on
like,
Sunday,
this fucking hurts.
Like, I texted you on Sunday and I was like, hey, I'm hearing it's done. And you're like, yeah, me too. And then we're just trying to figure out like
you
what
you knew
it was.
It was inevitable for
no, but it
weeks.
Wasn't. It wasn't just inevitable. Like, when I was like, hey, is this thing done? And somebody's like, yeah, it's done. It's done. And they're waiting to announce it for a bunch of different reasons. But yeah, honestly, like, Boston should not be in the category of a city.
Nobody wants
loses.
To hear Boston fans whine about it. But it's just, it's more, me, it's not just about the titles. It's about having somebody in your life beginning, middle, end of their careers. And I thought he was going to be one of those guys. Like, we grew up with Yaz. Yeah. Yaz Day 1983 meant something to me. He was in my life for the first 14 years of my life.
I was there.
Smoking cigarettes in the press conferences. Yeah,
I wasn't
you were
smoking
there.
Then. But
you weren't
I
mean, smoking?
I was 8.
But yeah, I think that shit means something. I think it means something that Ortiz finished with the Red Sox and what he meant to the city. And I think Mookie was going to be that guy. And they said no. We have to go.
Done.
Thanks for doing this trade deadline pod for Ryen Russillo. Thanks to the crew. Thanks to Kyle. And we will see you on Sunday night.